frustrated.
Of Metairie Park Country Day and your Ouachita Christian Eagles. My name is David Gordy. It's my privilege to bring you the play-by-play call tonight. Handling the color commentary as always, my Eagle teammate Saul Graves. Down on the sideline, our man on the field with the Marion State Bank sideline report, former Ouachita Christian defensive coordinator, Coach V, Sonny Vedrine. As usual, Donnie Haley's up here in the booth with us, bringing you and us all the numbers for tonight's contest. And back in the studio, the unlimited, talented hands of Aaron Collins. This thing, I can assure you, folks, doesn't get on the air without Aaron's skills. We're gonna take a minute to go down and catch up with Coach Sonny Vedrine with the Marion State Bank sideline report. And Coach, I got to tell you, I was thinking it was going to have a little chill in the air tonight, but really nice conditions down there right now.
I'm telling you, it is absolutely wonderful. It's wonderful. No wind blowing. It's got to be close to 65, 70 degrees probably. And, I mean, you couldn't ask for a better night, and this field is absolutely just in great shape. The teams look like they're in great shape. I mean, it's just, God, you can't ask for much better than a semifinal matchup, or the only thing better is going to be a championship matchup. But right now, we'll get this semifinal one done out of the way. Coach Fitchie's talking to the official. He'll be here in just a second. We'll get a chance to talk to him.
Well, Coach, it is interesting. You know, you think field turf, one field turf, you know them all. But last week over at Calvary Baptist, a nice field turf field, but nowhere really, I guess, you know, the age of the Calvary field, but nowhere really in near as nice a shape as the turf here at Fitchie Field.
No, it's really quite a bit of difference. And it's hard to tell it until you get on it, start playing on it, walking on it and everything. This field here is just phenomenal. I mean, on a scale of 1 to 10, it's a 10 and a half. And, I mean, it's just that nice. It really is. I haven't seen many of them this nice. But I know it's new and everything. But the one at Calvary was nice, but it wasn't quite up to par with this one. So kids are going to love it. It's going to be a great game to play in it. And, boy, we just can't wait to get it started, guys.
Thanks a lot. Coach Sonny Vedrine with the Marion State Bank sideline report. We'll go down to Coach when Coach Fitchie has a chance to break away from the official. Saw a great night for some high school football. The leaves are on the ground now. It's definitely fall. You were hoping for maybe a little chill in the air, but we don't have a chill tonight, as about 70 degrees is probably going to be our temperature at kickoff. But you can see the lights at Eagle Stadium miles away as you're driving in tonight. Playoff football at Eagle Stadium. And Saul, it's playoff football after Thanksgiving at Eagle Stadium tonight, and that's something we hadn't seen in a while, and hopefully a great night for this Ouachita Christian Eagle football team.
Yeah, you know, we had a little run there for a few years going back to 2012 where we were playing in Thanksgiving on Thanksgiving every year, and then we hit a little dry spell for a while, and it seems like it's been forever since we've been able to do that, and of course the improbable happened last week, and here we are tonight to play in a semifinal game on the day after Thanksgiving. It couldn't really get better in terms of high school football.
Well, it does. We've said this throughout the playoffs. It seems like this season started only a moment ago. But time does fly when you're having fun, and that's what this Eagle football team does. So, and big game, high stakes last week against Calvary Baptist. But this Eagle football team, this 2019 team, they're a fun team. They're a great group of guys that love playing football. And just as important, Saul, they seem like they really have a good time doing it.
Yeah, I mean, I would agree with that. I mean, I think they know how to take care of business. They got some seniors that are great leaders, and I think that's always so critical to a football team is having a group of seniors that know when to have fun and know when to get down to business. And they're certainly having fun this week after that game last week. But I tell you, if it had not been for that group of seniors, you get down 20-0 on the road against a team you're not supposed to beat. That makes a huge difference. I think those guys played a big role in that win last week.
Well, Coach Sonny Vedrine's caught up with Ouachita Christian head football coach Stephen Fitzhugh. And Coach, we're going to go down to the Marion State Bank right now with Ouachita Christian head football coach Stephen Fitzhugh. Coach, take it away.
Oh, thanks, guys. I got Coach Fitzhugh with me. Coach, I tell you what, last week was a game for the memory board. It really was. It was one of those games that you just will always remember and carry it with. It's an SEE game, what I always call an SEE game for our players this year, one of those very emotional event games. And they came out on top, and you just got to keep building on it now.
We do. I mean, again, it was a great, great win. Again, something those guys can reflect on and use in all areas of their life forever. That's what I say, you never quit. You never quit. No matter how bleak things look, you keep fighting, keep plugging, and good things will happen. And again, we were blessed with that tremendously last week. Give thanks to the Lord for that. And we came out this week, and as a challenge, said, guys, that game's over. We have a team standing our way of a state championship and play a very talented Country Day team tonight.
We really do, and they got a great quarterback. He's the most valuable player in the state last year and signed with Tulane and come out and throws the ball really well, so he's going to really test us on defense because they came here a few years ago, I think it was like 16, and put 500 yards on us in the second half. And it's one of those things we got to work against tonight, put pressure on him, not let him get comfortable, and see what we can do with him.
That's exactly right. And again, as we told our defense, make them play another play. Don't give up the big play, but we got to be physical tonight, both sides of the ball.
Coach, I was reading some of the letters that some of the old guys sent to us this week to kind of inspire the younger kids, and I tell you, it was pretty neat to listen to some of the things they said, and then we kind of brought back an old adage of bringing the wood, and we need to bring the wood tonight.
You're exactly right. So our guys are fired up. We're ready to go.
Everybody's ready? Nobody hurt? Everything's good?
All we
can just play the game?
We're good.
Go get them, Coach.
All right, thanks.
There you have it, guys. I tell you what, it's awesome to see some of the letters that some of the old players wrote to the kids this week, and just a lot of encouraging and telling them what it's all about. And we talk about it here at OCS a lot. It was one of those very emotional event games that we have around here sometimes and goes on our memory board in the locker room. And that game last week was definitely one of them. And you can't single out any one kid on that team because everybody played their hearts out. They never give up. They believe the whole time. And they did what they had to do to win that game. And tonight's going to be the same thing. They got to come out because the semifinals are special. It just is. To play it here at home on this new turf against a team that beat us once before here, and we got to be prepared for that. And like Coach Fitzhugh said, I think everybody is going to be on their A-game tonight.
All right. Thanks a lot, Coach Sonny Vedrine with the Marion State Bank Sideline Report. We're about 18 minutes away from getting tonight's contest underway. And I'll tell you what, Saul, it sounds like Coach Fitzhugh we've interviewed him all season. He's been real kind to do those with us. But tonight, you could tell his mind was somewhere else as he was talking to us. I think he's ready to get this football game underway.
Yeah, man, it's important. I mean, it's as important a game as we played all year long. And this is another do or die situation as the playoffs are. I think he's excited to be out here playing in the semifinals. And he would like nothing better, as would everybody else affiliated with Ouachita Christian, to be able to put your name in that the state final side of the bracket either next week or the week after. That'll be something I'm sure we'll talk about, but I'm not sure when it would take place, but doesn't matter when it'll take place. It just matters that you get there.
Absolutely. Well, again, we're about 17 minutes from getting tonight's contest underway. Again, going to have a 6 o'clock kickoff tonight. The folks from Metairie Park requesting a little earlier kickoff, try to take a little edge off the drive back to New Orleans. And Coach Fitzhugh and his staff are more than willing to accommodate, as well as the officials. Gonna get a kickoff early tonight at 6 o'clock. We're gonna take a quick break from here at Eagle Stadium. Want to thank everybody for tuning in tonight to 92.3 The Wolf for this Division IV semifinal playoff contest between the Cajuns of Metairie Park Country Day and your Ouachita Christian Eagles. You're listening to Eagle Football on 92.3 The Wolf. Campus of Ouachita Christian School, Eagle Stadium. The Ouachita Christian Eagles hosting the Cajuns of Metairie Park Country Day in the Division IV semifinal round of the Louisiana High School Athletic Association playoffs. About 14 minutes from getting tonight's contest underway. Again, a little early kickoff here at Eagle Stadium as the Eagles accommodating a request from Metairie Park to get a head start on the trip back down to New Orleans tonight. 6 o'clock, we're going to kick this game off and underway. Been in the playoffs for a couple of weeks now. Saw you alluded to it a little early in the broadcast. A huge win last week over a really good, a great Calvary Baptist team. Down to a four-team field now here in Division IV. A win tonight, and this Eagle team will have that shot at a state championship. Now, one of the things you talked about, and we'll just spend a brief moment on it, is where, if the Eagles are able to pull this game off, and this is a really good football team, but if the Eagles are able to win tonight, I think there's a couple of twists, maybe some turns, that would decide exactly where we play this game next week or the week after.
Yeah, and I guess to get into that, you kind of got to go back to the beginning of 2019 when the select schools decided to form what they call the Select School Association. Still a part of the LHSA, but an association was formed to try to maybe meet the needs a little bit better of the select schools. And what they decided to do at that meeting was that they decided that the select schools were going to pull out of the state championship games that were being played in the Dome for a variety of reasons, decided that they would no longer play the select school games in the Dome like the public schools would, and the select schools would play the state championship a week earlier, so it would be next week. There wouldn't be a bye between their last game and the Dome. And then the rule was going to be that the two teams that make it to the state championship game in the select division would determine or decide on whether or not to play in a neutral field, and if they could both agree on a neutral field, then that's where they would play it. If not, then the higher seed, or I guess the lower seed is what it is, the team with the best ranking, would play it at their home field. And so Coach Fitzhugh, however, did not agree with that decision. And so way back in January, he sent a letter to Eddie Bonine, who's the head of the LHSA, requesting that if the Eagles were lucky enough to make the state championship, and if they were the the high seed, that they would want to play on a neutral site in the Superdome. Now, he's not heard back from Eddie Bonanno, so he doesn't know if that request would be honored. So here's the way it would happen. If we were to win tonight, we would be the number five seed. Catholic High Point, Capilla, and Southern Lab are the 6 and 7 seeds. And so we would host if we decide to play it on our home field. However, Coach Fitzhugh's already talked to both those schools, and if we were to make it the state championship, they have both agreed that they would be willing to play it in the Dome in 2 weeks. So now it would be just up to the LHSA as to whether or not they would grant us that opportunity to play in the Dome. If they won't do that, then the game will likely be here at Eagle Field next week, and that would either be probably on a Friday or Thursday or Friday night, maybe next week is when they would play it.
Well, you and I both had a chance to play in the Superdome for a state championship, and it is really a neat, it's a once-in-a-lifetime type venue for a lot of young guys to have a chance to play in the New Orleans Superdome. But, you know, just as much, I mean, I can't imagine what it would be like for Ouachita Christian to host a state championship game here at the school. It would be the first time in the history of the school to have anything like that happen here.
Yeah, not to mention it would be a huge advantage, in my opinion, if you get to play the game at home for a state championship. I mean, that's a to me, you go to the Dome, and it's a neutral field. Now, but the other side of the argument is that, you know, it's just a once-in-a-lifetime experience that none of these players on this team has ever experienced because it's been so long since we've been to the Dome. And so, you know, it'd be a chance for those guys to be able to play a state championship in the Superdome, which is what Coach Fitzhugh wants to have happen.
Well, before we do that, we got to beat a good team in Metairie Park Country Day who's made the trip up here tonight. And Ouachita Christian is trying to tie the series up tonight. And there's a good reason for that. There's only been one game between these two football teams. And tonight marks the second time we'll square off against the Cajuns of Metairie Park. The first time back in 2015. And Metairie Park walked away from Eagle Stadium that night, Saul, with a win 35-42 over the Eagles. And, you know, it was, in my opinion, you and I have been doing these games for 10 years now. It's the most impressive performance I've ever seen by a quarterback as I think Metairie Park rolled up over 500 yards passing that night.
Yeah, certainly the most, in terms of yardage, the most impressive performance. His name was Christian Carood, and he basically shredded our defense that night for 521 yards passing and some huge plays down the stretch to win the ball game. The Eagles actually had a chance to put the game away and score on the 1 yard line, and they stopped us and drove all the way down the field and scored, and then I believe scored one more time after that to win the football game. So, at least it was a good quarterback, and you'd hope that maybe tonight we wouldn't be facing quite as good a quarterback, but unfortunately that's not the case. I think this quarterback is even better than the quarterback we faced that night. A guy named Justin Abiata, number 13, big kid, 6'5", or listed as 6'5", 215. Coach Vedrine already has mentioned that, he said he signed with Tulane. He's not yet signed with Tulane. He's committed to Tulane, and I assume will sign either in December or February, whenever he decides to do that. So he's a very good quarterback and very, very accurate quarterback as well.
Metairie Park Country Day School is located in Metairie, Louisiana. The Cajuns had a pretty good drive to get up here to Eagle Stadium tonight, about a 4.5-hour drive, and that's a pretty good road trip in anybody's book, but especially getting ready for a semifinal playoff game as they are tonight. The Eagles enter tonight's contest, as Saul alluded to earlier, as the number 5 seed in Division 4. The Eagles come into tonight's contest seeded number 5. And once you're seeded in these things, it never changes no matter who you beat. The Cajuns come into tonight as the number 8 seed. The Eagles' only loss coming by way of the 3A Sterlington Panthers. The Cajuns enter tonight's game with losses to De La Salle, Isidore Newman, Riverside, and West St. John. Saul, a lot of victories for the Cajuns, but also with those 4 losses, do those losses tell us anything about this team coming up from Metairie Park?
Well, I think one thing it tells us is they actually played a pretty tough schedule. They only played 8 games this year, which is a little bit unusual. But those losses, 3 of those losses, one was to De La Salle, who's the number 2 seed in Division 2. The other loss was to Newman, who's the number 4 seed in Division 3. They also lost to West St. John, who's the number 1 seed in the 1A public school bracket. Then the 4th loss, probably the most disappointing, was to Riverside, who the Eagles saw here a few years ago and had a great team, but they were not near as good this year. And I know that was probably the most disappointing game of the season for Country Day, and the fact that they lost that game to Riverside. But you know, you can see that those three of those 4 losses were to very, very, very good football teams. And so It just tells you they played a tough schedule. And, you know, they're a good football team, and they beat a good football team last week. They beat the number one seed in the playoffs, Vermilion Catholic, at their place in a driving rainstorm. And so you think that Country Day, whose forte is throwing the football, it would be tough on to win a game on the road in the rain, and they were able to pull it off with a victory.
The head coach for the Ouachita Christian Eagles in his 22nd season is Stephen Fitchew. Coach Fitchew with a career record of 203 wins against 74 losses. The head coach for the Cajuns in his fifth year is Joe Chango, with an impressive overall career record of 43 wins against 9 losses for the Cajuns. All right, so all Eagle fans always want to know, and we already know, you already think you know, what it's going to take for the Eagles to win this game tonight. Without further ado, Sauce, keys to victory.
Well, I already mentioned the quarterback, Damon, what a good player he is. He's thrown for over 1,700 yards this year in 10 games, 25 TDs. He's also rushed for 650 yards. And they're going to move the football there. They've got good receivers that can catch the football well. And I think the key on defense is we've got to win in the red zone. So when that field shrinks, when they get inside the 20, you got a chance to make plays, that's when you got to do it. On offense, I think we've got to win the line of scrimmage and be able to run the football. We're going to be bigger than these guys, and we got to physically wear them down just like we did against Calvary last week. They only got 38 players on their roster, and three of their four defensive linemen actually go both ways.
Well, let's go down for the coin toss, and Coach Sonny Vedrine with the Marion State Bank sideline report. Coach, take it away.
Congratulations for getting here, okay? You guys in charge for me. Any problems, y'all take care of them. Keep your teams under control for me. Talking, y'all talk to your team, y'all talk to your team. Okay, heads. Tails, I'm going to let it hit the ground. What you want?
Heads.
Heads, he says. Here we go. And it is tails. Deferred, right?
Sound like a good deal, guys. We won the toss, and we're going to defer and kick off, so we'll have the ball beginning of the second half, like we always do. So looks like things are going according to plan so far.
All right, thanks a lot. Coach Sonny Vedrine with the Marion State Bank sideline report. Saul, I know you got a third key to victory.
And I'm saying the same thing over and over again. It's, again, we got to win the turnover battle. Again, plus 27 on the year. I mentioned it last week. Only four teams in the history of OCS football have had a plus 20 or better turnover ratio. Every one of them finished in the state championship game. And let's hope this one does the same.
All right. Well, we're going to take our final break from here in our pregame show at Eagle Stadium. I want to invite you to come back for tonight's kickoff. You're listening to Eagle Football on 92.3 The Wolf.
Both communities being able to gather here together to enjoy a football game, we pray that you would give each of us safe travel and a good night. We pray that you be with all the players involved in the game. We pray for good sportsmanship. We ask for safety for all of those who are playing. We thank you for the opportunity. We pray for a good game, a safe game, and we thank you for all that you have done for us, namely for the hope that we have through Jesus Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Turn it up, man.
Lord, the land.
Eagle Stadium, Ouachita Christian School. The Eagles hosting the Cajuns of Metairie Park Country Day. The Eagles won the coin toss and have elected to defer to receive in the second half. Christopher Holyfield's going to tee it up at the 40-yard line for the Eagles. Deep for the Cajuns, number one, Tyler Williams. And looks like number, well, 10. Tough to tell, number 10, that's Daniel Conwell as well. They'll stand at the 10-yard line to receive Holyfield's kick. Christopher teeing it up at the 40-yard line as we get ready to get tonight's contest underway. Christopher takes a nice long approach and really gets his leg into this one. He's going to bounce at about the 10-yard line and travel into the end zone, and that is going to be a touchback for Metairie Park, and they'll start this drive at their own 20-yard line.
Dave, it's going to be interesting to see how we choose to defend Country Day. Again, this quarterback, Abiata, is very, very accurate, and he's got receivers that catch the ball extremely well. You know, I don't think they're quite as dynamic in terms of breaking the big play as the Country Day receivers we saw a few years ago, but they don't drop anything and they run very good routes.
Number 13, Justin Abiata, brings the Cajuns to the line. Abiata with the ball first and 10 at the 20-yard line. He's going to turn. He hands this one inside to the fullback, the first man through, and he's going to pick up a yard, no more. Stingy defense from the Eagles early on.
They're interested that they try to go power, which they have done a few times I've seen mainly in goal line situations, but I think they're going to try to see. They wanted to see how we were going to play them in this power formation. And one thing, their best receiver is a guy named Tyler Williams, number one. They had him single covered with Landon Graves on the last running play, and so wouldn't be surprised me if they tried to set us up to see if they can throw it to him on this play. But it looks like we're going to play a little bit different defense and cover him up with a couple of receivers.
Abiata under center, going to turn and hand this one to the deep back. And it's going to be a nice gain on the play. Actually, on the carry is number 7, Dylan Simmons. And Simmons is going to pick up 6 yards on the play. So the first drive of the night for the Cajuns, you're going to be looking at 3rd and 3. As a nice gain that time by Simmons on the carry. Just kind of off-tackle play that time. It's all out of an eye backfield. A gain of 6 yards. 3rd down and 3 here for the Cajuns.
Yeah, it looked like Eagles had him wrapped up, and he did a nice job of breaking some tackles and getting into a short yarded situation on 3rd down.
Abiata's going to go under center. A power eye backfield. Now they shift out of it. They're going to send 2 receivers wide to the left, 1 to the right. Abiata in the gun. Looks to keep this one on the ground himself, and he's going to be close to a 1st down. Depends on where they spot this one. And it is going to be enough for a 1st down. So on the initial drive, going to be the first 1st down of the night for the Cajuns. Needed 3, picked up 4. 1st down and 10 for Metairie Park at their own 32-yard line.
And Abiata is their best rusher as well, David. Actually has over 2,300 yards rushing in his career at Metairie Park Country Day. And he's a big kid and hard to bring down. You saw it there. He was just a short yard situation. The Eagles made a nice tackle on him, but couldn't bring him down before the sticks.
Abiata listed at 6'5", 215 pounds. 1st down and 10 for the Cajuns. Quite a change from the I formation a moment ago. Abiata looks, throws this one out in the flat, complete to Simmons. Simmons has got running room. He's across the 40-yard line. Going to be real close to another Cajun 1st down. Nobody out in the flat that time, Saul, until late. And it looks like the Cajuns are going to gain 9, bring up 2nd down and 1.
Yeah, John Thomas Dixon was the one responsible for the flat that time, and he was an inside linebacker. And so they just beat him to the outside, just ran a little flare route. And, you know, Abiata does a great job of reading defenses as well, and he's going to throw it to the right person most of the time. And that time he picked the right guy and didn't pick up the 1st down, but it was very close.
Well-thrown football, led his receiver to the line of scrimmage. Abiata, again, is going to break formation. This time they do set up in a power eye formation. 2nd down and 1. They give this one to the up back. Needed 1, picked up 2, and that's going to be another 1st down for the Cajuns as they find themselves 1st and 10 at their own 43-yard line.
Yeah, the Eagles tonight look like they maybe going with a little bit of extra, an extra defensive back. They're playing, going with 4 defensive backs as well as Cade Woods, a strong safety. So really 5 defensive backs, a nickel type defense to try to shut this passing game down.
1st down and 10 for the Cajuns. Ball at their own 43-yard line. Abiata is going to send a man in motion. Does. They're going to fake this. They're going to lose a handle on the speed sweep. Abiata is going to pick it up himself, and he is going to be mauled. about five Eagle defenders combining to make the stop. Just lost the handle on the exchange with the speed sweep saw. They're going to lose 6 yards on the play.
Yeah, it looked like that was on Avieta to me. It looked like he didn't put the ball in his pocket, kind of got a little nonchalant with it and sort of hit him on his hip. And they're fortunate to recover the football, but a big play for the Eagle defense as it puts them in a long yard situation.
Second down and 17 for the Cajuns. Spot this football now at the Metairie Park 35-yard line. 8 minutes and 13 seconds left to play here in the first quarter. No score at Eagle Stadium. Avieta goes to the wristband. Three receivers split wide to the left, one to the right. Cajuns traveling from left to right on your radio dial, and Avieta winds up for his first long ball of the night, and it's going to be well overthrown as he was looking for number one, Tyler Williams. Ran out of real estate on the sideline, and now you're going to be looking at the first third down and long for the Cajuns. Actually going to be third and 17 to be exact with the ball at their own 35-yard line.
And Tyler Williams is their best receiver today. Looks like the Eagles have committed to trying to take him away. That time they had Landon Graves rolled up underneath him and fits you over the top and no chance to complete that football. I'm really surprised that Avieta even chose to throw it to him as he was not only double covered, but if he ran a slant inside, they actually had the linebacker. The Eagles did drop it out in the flat to take that away too.
Cajuns again go to the wristband. Lone running back in the shotgun with Avieta. Good snap from center. Looks to throw. He's going to feel pressure immediately. Now he's going to pull it down. He's got running room, and he's going to have enough for another Cajun first down. Saul, you alluded to it early in the broadcast. Avieta can definitely throw the football, but capable of running it as well. As looks like it's going to be, well, they'll spot him just shy of the first down. Fourth down and one. Big play here, and it looks like the Cajuns are going to go for this one. Ball is going to be at the Eagle 48.
Yeah, good job, Avieta. Seeing the coverage, Eagles dropped everybody back, just rushed a few guys and created an easy running lane for the quarterback. And he was very close to first down, and you ought to probably see him take it himself right here.
Fourth down, less than a yard, about a half a yard. Avieta turns, hands this one up the middle. That's going to be the fullback on the carry. A nice run that time, needed one. Picked up well in excess of that is actually on the carry that time was number 54 for the Cajuns. That's Isaacs as he picks up 4 yards when he needed one. First down and 10 for the Cajuns now at the Eagle 40-yard line.
The Eagles doing a good job so far tonight, David, not giving up the big play, what Coach Fitch, you talked about. You just got to keep squeezing them, and again, it gets tougher on those guys once you get inside the 30 to 20-yard line there. That's when you got to really play your best defense and keep them out of the end zone.
Number 13, Justin Avieta, going to call his own number that time, and he's going to get dropped. Picked up 3 yards, a tough run that time as Eagles hanging all over him. Good effort out of Avieta as he picks up three, but it's going to bring up second down and 7 for Metairie Park at the Eagle 38-yard line.
Yeah, good job by Ethan Hogan that time coming off the edge as he really took a nice angle and was able to wrap Avieta up around his knees and keep him from getting an even bigger gain than that. So nice job holding 3 yards on first down.
Second down and 7 for the Cajuns at the Eagle 38. 6 minutes and 20 seconds left to play in the first quarter. No score at Eagle Stadium. Opening drive of the night for Metairie Park. Avieta pulls this one down, looks to throw. Now he's going to he's going to keep it himself. Got running room, still on his feet, still stumbling, still moving the pile forward. He's going to be inside the red zone. Ball comes out late, but it's going to be well after he was taken down. Going to be first down and 10 for the Cajuns at the Eagle 20-yard line, a gain of 16. It's going to be first down and 10 at the Eagle, well, actually 21.
And I think it's kind of always difficult for a defense when you haven't played somebody before to realize really how big and physical he is. And you saw about three OCS defenders that time have a chance to stop him and just slid off his legs because he's such a big, strong kid. And, they just got to wrap up and hang on and there's a big play, good play by a good football player that time to pick up the first down.
Avieta in the shotgun. Again, fakes this one, takes it inside. He's going to be hammered at the line of scrimmage. No gain on the play. Actually, Donnie's going to say a loss of 3 yards. Going to bring up second down and 13 for the Cajuns at the Eagle 24-yard line.
What a great job by nose guard Blake Pitt at that time. He just blew up the center, knocked him back in the backfield. Avieta actually faked the football and then was carrying it inside and no place for him to run as Pender just completely destroyed the lineman that time and just knocked him back in the backfield and was able to tackle Avieta for a loss.
Second down 13 for the Cajuns. Ball at the Eagle 24. Avieta in the gun. Takes a good snap from center. Looks to throw. He's got pressure. The Eagles are going to have him. And Giants second, third, fourth, and fifth effort. Solid took four Eagle defenders to bring him down, but he's going to lose another 3 yards on the play. Boy, I tell you, the initial contacts all looked like we were going to drop him for a loss, but a big, strong quarterback in Avieta. It took several Eagles to get the job done, but they did. Another loss, so you're looking now at third and 16.
Yeah, good job by Ogden that time. He came in for Pender, and he also pushed the center backwards and got back there first. He didn't make the sack, but held him up enough for Shaw to get there, and then several other Eagles, as you mentioned, came in to sack him.
Third down and 16. Biggest play so far of the drive for the Cajuns. Ball at the Eagle 26-yard line. Eagles show blitz and back out of it. Avieta looks to throw. He's going to put some air under this one. It's going to be complete out in the flat. And it's going to be short of the first down, it looks like, from here. We'll have to wait on the official mark or official spot of the ball. But it is going to be fourth down and 3 for the Cajuns. Actually, let's call it fourth and 4.
Yeah, Country Day with a very good field goal kicker, but they're going to elect it to go for it here. I think they realize it's going to be a high-scoring ball game. The Eagles are going to be able to score, and so they want to go for it here and try to put a touchdown on the board.
Fourth down and 4. They spot the ball at the Eagle 15-yard line. 3 minutes and 22 seconds left to play in the first quarter. No score at Eagle Stadium. Opening drive of the night for Metairie Park. Avieta goes to the wristbands. Three receivers to the left, one to the right. And the Cajuns are going to take a quick timeout. First quarter of Ouachita Christian football is sponsored by American National, the Darren Dugan Agency, for all your home, auto, life, and business insurance needs. Call Darren Dugan today, 318-807-2100. That's 318-807-2100. Again, we'd like to thank the Darren Dugan Agency for their support of Ouachita Christian Athletics. Let's take a moment to go down to the sideline and catch up with Coach Sonny Vadreen and the Marion State Bank sideline report. Coach, how you doing?
Oh, man, it's a great game right now. It's just a good feeling out process, see what everybody can do, and they're moving the ball fairly well. Defense has come up with a couple good plays and some good penetration, and this probably could be the first, what you call, big play of the game on this fourth down. We need to get them come up short and hold them out of here instead of getting a touchdown or a first down on this play, guys.
All right. Thanks a lot, Coach Sonny Vadreen with the Marion State Bank sideline report. Saul, what do you like on fourth and 4 out of Metairie Park?
Well, man, they run a lot of different routes. And one thing I saw on film is they like to do they put to a three-receiver side. They're gonna put you in a bind. They're going to put somebody in the flat. They're going to run a couple of curls behind it. With fourth and 4, you can pretty much do whatever you want to in this situation. So looks like they actually got two receivers to either side. And so they give Avieta a choice of where he wants to go.
Avieta in the gun. Pulls down. Throws. Got a complete pass at the 10-yard line. Maybe even, well, now they're going to, they rule it an interception. They're going to say the Eagles come up with it. And Saul actually on the interception for Ouachita Christian is number 2. Walker Morris is going to come up with a football. Let's go down to Coach Sonny Vadreen for the Marion State Bank sideline report. Coach, happened right in front of you.
That was a great move by Walker Morris. As the guy caught the ball, he kind of turned around, and Walker turned around with him, reached in, and grabbed the ball before he ever hit the ground. Great move by Walker. Great recovery right there, guys. You call it a fumble recovery, interception, whatever it is, but we got the ball.
All right. Thanks a lot, Coach Sonny Vadreen. Huge play that time. A defensive stop for the Eagles.
And what I talked about, you got to squeeze them in the red zone. And that's what they did. They get in the red zone, and that's where the plays get tighter. The Eagles come out with a big one.
Hunter Herring brings the Eagles to the line. Junior quarterback number 11. As we got a momentary stoppage of play, Herring is going to be in the shotgun. Looks like Dugan joins him in the gun. Actually going to turn, hands this one to Dugan, and he's going to find tough sledding up the middle of the field. And that's actually Will Fitzhugh. Fitzhugh's going to pick up 3 yards on the play. Going to bring up second down and 7. Got an Eagle shaken up on the play. Looks like number 21, Bub Mathern, nursing a lower ankle, lower leg injury. And he's helped off the field. Gain of 3 on the play for Will Fitzhugh. Opening drive of the night for the Eagles. 2 minutes and 30 seconds left to play in the first quarter. Herring in the shotgun. Gets a good snap from center. He's going to keep it himself. Tries to find running room up the middle of the field. Metairie Park sniffs it out. Going to be a gain of 1 yard on the play, but going to bring up the first third down of the night for the Eagles. It's going to be third down and 6. Looks like they'll spot this football about the, let's call it the Metairie Park 14-yard line.
Yeah, Eagles trying to run the football, and Metairie Park doing a good job those first two plays of stopping them just for a couple of yards on each play. And so the Eagles with a, big third down here in deep inside your own territory. Certainly don't want to give the ball back to Country Day this quick.
Two receivers split wide to the right. Two running backs in the shotgun with Herring. Third and five. Herring out of the gun, turns, fakes this one to Fitzhugh. Now he rolls, looks downfield, got a receiver. It's going to be incomplete. Had a man down there, and it just goes in and out of the hands of his intended receiver. So it looks like the receiver may be shaken up on the play. Looked like he was actually looking for Cade Woods. It's going to bring up fourth down for the Eagles. Their first drive going to be three and out.
Yeah, did a little bootleg that time, and I almost thought he could have run for the first down right there, but probably the right thing to do to throw the football. He just threw it a little bit behind Cade Woods, and Cade Woods not able to come up with it.
Eagles' first drive is going to be three and out. Landon Graves stands at his goal line to punt the football. Minute and 50 left to play. Low snap, and Graves is going to get his worst punt of the year off that time. So as Landon has done a great job punting the football, but that ball depends on where they actually mark this one. But it looks like they'll spot it. Well, they're still walking backwards to the 28-yard line. Gonna have to wait for the math on that one. But punt couldn't have traveled more than 15 or 20 yards at the most. Actually, 14-yard punt out of Graves that time. So it's going to bring up first down and 10 for Metairie Park at the Eagle 28-yard line.
Yeah, not a good offensive start for the Eagles that time, as they really came to this ball game thinking that we'd be able to run the football on them pretty easily. At least I did. You know, they did a great job of shutting us down deep in our own territory. And so now Eagles got to bow their neck again on defense.
Justin Ibieta is going to turn and hand this football off, and there's going to be a loss on the play. The Eagle defense doing a great job that time as he was looking for number 23, Christian Daly, on the carry and lost two yards on the play, so it's going to bring up second down and 12.
Yeah, really good job by Christopher Holyfield that time as he gets credit for the tackle for loss that time. And the Eagle defensive line doing a great job of getting penetration and really shutting this running game down so far. The only real good running plays that Country Day has had has been with Ibieta scrambling and picking up good yardage that way.
Inside a minute to play in the first quarter. No score at Eagle Stadium. Ibieta gets a good snap. He does roll. Looks downfield to throw. Now he's going to keep it himself. He's going to have running room. Going to be real close to a first down. If they spot it with a ref standing, it's going to be enough for a first down for the Cajuns, as they'll spot it at about the Eagle 18-yard line. First down, Cajuns.
Yeah, just a rollout that time, a spread out pass, and Ibieta couldn't find anybody to throw it to. And Ethan Hogan had a chance to make a play on him in the open field and just sort of bounced off of him. And Ibieta picks up the first down easy. So here comes Country Day again, back in the red zone. This is where the Eagles have got to squeeze them down and be able to stop them again on this drive.
First down and 10 for the Cajuns. Ball at the Eagle 18-yard line. Clock stops with 43 seconds left to play in the first quarter. No score here at Eagle Stadium. Ibieta is going to take this one again. They work on the ground, and again, the Eagle defense is stingy. It looks like if they spot it there, no gain on the play. Going to bring up second down and 10 for the Cajuns. Second possession of the night for Country Day.
Really interesting how much Country Day is trying to run the football here in this first quarter. And as you can see, the first quarter is about to run out of time because they spent just about the whole first quarter running the football, and that's really not what I expected to see, and probably won't in what we're going to see the entire ball game. But certainly Country Day's committing to the run here in these first two drives.
Ibieta rolls out, looks to throw, pulls this one down. He's got a man, and that's complete. So you talked about accuracy early in the broadcast. That's probably one of the more accurate passes we've seen all season, as he throws a dart to C.D. St. Hilaire, and Hilaire pulls it in at, let's call it the Eagle 3-yard line. Gain of 15 yards. It's going to be first and goal at the Eagle 3.
That's right. Perfect throw on the run that time as St. Hilaire catches it. And all these receivers do a good job. In fact, between St. Hilaire and Tyler Williams, they've got over 70 receptions on the year and over 1,000 yards of receiving between those two guys.
Well, we're going to it's going to bring an end to the first quarter of play here at Eagle Stadium. We'll take a quick break. You're listening to Wachita Christian Eagle football on 92.3 The Wolf. Eagle Stadium, the campus of Ouachita Christian School. The Division IV quarterfinals, the LHSAA playoffs. Metairie Park Country Day is going to find themselves with first and goal at the 3-yard line. As we start the second quarter of play. Quarterback Justin Abietta is going to go under center. He's going to turn, gives this one to the up back. He's not going to make it in, Saul. They stack him up just short of the goal line. A gain of one, well, probably going to give him two on the play. That's going to bring up second down and goal at the Eagle 1-yard line.
Yeah, once again, that was one of their linemen. Number, I couldn't tell if that's 53 or 54, but I think it was 53 that carried it on that play. And, no, 54 is who it was. Is that Isaac?
Is that Isaac's. Yeah. Isaac's is who we don't have 54 on our roster, Saul, but we do have a 54 penciled in as Isaac's. They turn, they hand this one again to the fullback. And, again, the Eagles look like they stack him up at the line of scrimmage. But the officials are going to give him credit for a touchdown. Looked like he lost forward momentum, but the Cajuns able to push him across. And that's going to be the first touchdown of the night, and it's going to go to Metairie Park Country Day.
Yeah, good job by Isaacs that time of keeping his feet turning, and actually had another player come and sort of help him into the end zone to push him back in there. And, you know, once he got hit by an Eagle defender, I kept waiting for some other Eagles to get there to kind of push him the other way, but none of them arrived, and the Country Day gets on the board first with a touchdown on the ground.
Actually, number 54 we saw is Scott Isaacs as he puts the first points on the board for the Cajuns. The extra point attempt is going to be good, and Metairie Park will extend their lead over the Eagles 7-0. Second possession of the night for Metairie Park. The Eagles have had the ball one time, got stymied, unable to move the football, 3 and out for the Eagles on their opening possession. 11 minutes and 20 seconds left to play here in the second quarter. The second quarter, Ouachita Christian Eagle football sponsored by D&H Sporting Goods. Visit D&H Sporting Goods location in Sterlington for all your Ouachita Christian Eagle gear. I would like to thank the folks at D&H for their longtime support of Ouachita Christian athletics. And it looks like we've got penalties going against both teams. Not really sure what the indication was, Saul, but doesn't look like anything's going to be marked off. Let's go down to the sideline and catch up with Coach Sonny Vedrine in the Marion State Bank sideline report. Coach?
Yeah, it was called running into the kicker on that penalty. They're going to get a little penalty on the kickoff here, so we got to be aware of the onside kick this time. Going to gain an extra 10 yards on us.
All right, so they're going to actually spot this football for play at the 35. Thanks a lot, Coach. Coach Sonny Vedrine with the Marion State Bank sideline report as they do mark off the penalty. So the Cajuns saw are going to kick this one from the 45-yard line. As Coach alluded to, you'd definitely want to be aware of the onside kick, but it doesn't look like it's teed up, nor does the approach indicate that this is going to be an onside kick. Number 22 for the Cajuns is going to handle the kicking chores. That's Andrew Lopez. Lopez stands at his 35 for the approach. It's going to be a high kick, and it's going to be hammered. It's going to travel well into the end zone. Will Fitzhugh is going to watch it fly over, and it's going to be first down and 10 for Ouachita Christian, this time with the ball at their own 20-yard line.
Yeah, big drive for the Eagles this time. And, again, with Country Day's offense, with how good it is, you certainly don't want to give them a couple of possession lead. And you want to come down this time and put some points on the board or at least drive the football down the field some. You know, that poor punt, that 14-yard punt, was essentially a turnover in your own territory, and it led to points by Country Day, and as a result, a 7-0 lead for them.
Four receiver set for the Eagles. 3 to the right, 1 to the left. Lone running back is Dugan. Turn. They hand this one. No, he keeps it. Hunter's going to look for running room, and now he's going to dump it off to Will Fitzhugh, and Fitzhugh is going to pick up decent yardage. I'm not sure. It looked like maybe one of the RPOs, Saul, but a gain of 7 yards on the play. Hunter probably could have picked up the same 7, keeping it himself, but it is going to be 2nd down and 3.
Yeah, it was one of those things where Fitzhugh kind of hangs out on the sideline, and Hunter runs the football and can throw it out there to him with a longer throw, but he ran it around the outside, and then he was so close to him, he actually threw it to him and probably shouldn't have done that, probably should have just pitched it to him.
Herring in the shotgun, sends Fitzhugh in motion. He's going to keep this one himself. He's got tough running inside, but he's going to have more than enough for a first down. Ouachita Christian saw has a pretty big quarterback that can run the football as well, as Herring picks up 8 yards on the carry.
Yeah, nice job by Hunter Herring. Of course, we saw a lot of Hunter Herring last week against Calvary, and junior quarterback had a great game last week against Calvary, both in the air and on the ground, and of course had a big fourth down run to keep that drive alive, and ultimately ended up the Eagles going ahead on a touchdown pass from Hunter Herring to Eli Eckstein.
First down and 10 for the Eagles. Herring's going to give this one to Eckstein. Eckstein's not going to make it back to the line of scrimmage. He's going to lose a yard on the play as the Cajuns were ready for the speed sweep that time. Saw they stretch it out, and it's going to be no gain on the play. Eckstein able to make it back to the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, and a really good job by number one, Tyler Williams, for Country Day. As it was the Eagles' job to try to keep him inside and turn him in, and he did a great job of fighting off the block and stopping Eckstein for no gain.
Herring in the shotgun. Three receivers to his left, one to his right. Sends Fitzhugh in motion. Fitzhugh's going to stop motion in the backfield, and again, he's going to lead Herring up the middle of the field. Herring pushing the pile. Great run that time. They're probably going to mark him a little short of the first down. Yeah, well, actually, now they back it up. It's going to depend on the spot, but he looks like he's going to be just shy of the first down. Close enough for a measurement.
The tip of the football is on the line, and now they're going to scoot it back a little bit more. That probably is the right spot, David. I don't think it looked like to me he picked up the first down when he got tackled. So
13 inches.
I think they've got it right.
Herring in the shotgun. Again, sends Fitzhugh in motion. Again, gets a good snap. This time they go with Eckstein. Or actually, that's Dugan. Dugan's going to make it across the 45, close to midfield before he's dropped. Going to be a gain of 6 yards and enough for a community pharmacy first down as the Eagles continue to move the football on their second drive of the night. First and 10 at midfield.
Yeah, and a little nice variation on that same motion play where they motion Fitzhugh inside on the play before they run Herring to left side. This time they motion Fitzhugh inside and Fitzhugh sort of runs across the formation and blocks for Dugan going back the other way.
Herring with an offset eye backfield. Herring's going to keep this one himself inside the 45-yard line. Gain of 5 yards on the play, and that's going to bring up second down and 5. Eagles gashing this Country Day defense all for 5 yards at a time now.
Yeah, this is a little bit more like what I expected to see. You know, the Eagles pushing that pile back, pushing their defensive lineman back on every run. And Herring, again, as you mentioned, the big kid, he's falling forward on every play. So the Eagles doing exactly what I expected them to do, running the football against this Country Day defense.
Second down and 5. Ball at the Country Day 46-yard line. Herring in the shotgun. Two running backs joining. Turns, hands this one to Dugan. Dugan's going to bounce it outside. Tough run by Dugan. Real close to a first down. If they spot it where the official is at, it's going to be enough. No indication from the officials yet, and now they do. Another community pharmacy first down for the Eagles. First down and 10. Ouachita Christian, ball at the Country Day 40-yard line. 7 minutes and 52 seconds left to play here in the first half. First quarter is already gone. Three wide receivers split wide to the right, one to the left. Lone running back is Dugan. Herring calls for the ball, turns, hands this one to Dugan. Dugan is going to run kind of a semi-draw, maybe just a dive play inside. And that time, a pretty minimal gain. Let's call it 3. It's going to bring up second down and 7 for the Eagles. They'll spot this one at the Country Day 37-yard line.
It looks like somebody was hurt for Country Day. That may be number 54 for Country Day, who's their best defensive player, David. You've already seen him be very, very valuable on offense, you know, running in short yardage situations. But it looks like he's up now walking around.
He's up under his own power, but he is definitely going to have to take a play off as the official stop play to check on his well-being, and he's going to be helped off. Well, not helped off. He's going to walk off under his own power with the trainer. But there is a stoppage of play as a result. So it's going to be second down and, let's say, a short 7 long, or short 8, long 7 for the Eagles with this football at the Country Day 37-yard line.
Yeah, this is definitely 4 down territory, David. I think with the way Country Day moves there, moves the football on offense, and, you know, with us not being able to get anything on our first drive, I think here you're looking at 3 plays now to pick up the first down.
Second down and 7. Ball at the Country Day 37-yard line. Herring in the shotgun. Dugan joins him in the gun. One receiver left, 3 to his right. Sends Fitzhugh in motion across the formation. Fitchu sets up. They're going to lead this one, and Herring's going to find some running room. He's going to get across the 45-yard line, a gain of 4 yards on the play. That's going to set up a third down and short for the Eagles, actually third and four, as they put this football at the Country Day 34-yard line. Yeah, 6 minutes and 42 seconds left to play in the second quarter.
Nice tackle by C.D. St. Hilaire, who's a receiver also for Country Day. You'll notice that we'll say the same names over and over again on offense and defense because they've got a lot of kids going both ways, but a good open field tackle to hold Herring to just a 4-yard gain.
Third down and four for the Eagles. They keep this one on the ground, and that's going to be Herring, and Herring is going to move the pile. They're going to give him forward progress across, or at least, yeah, a little bit across the 30-yard line, and that should be enough for another Community Pharmacy first down, and it is. They move the chains. First down and 10 Eagles at the Cajun 30-yard line.
What's interesting, Dave, is that every time we pick up these last three first downs, it's been right on the line of the game, on the 50, on the 40, on the 30, and the Eagles just getting just enough to pick up those first downs. Good run by Hunter Herring.
Herring in the gun. Two running backs join him. It's Dugan and Fitzhugh. Two receivers split wide to the left, one to the right. Herring calls for the ball, gets a good snap. They keep it on the ground to Dugan. Dugan with a slash and run. He's going to be inside the 20-yard line. Saul, you called it just a second ago. It looks like they're going to stop him right at the 20-yard line, but that's going to be enough for another Community Pharmacy first down as they spot it exactly 10 yards away from where it was last time.
I'm seeing exactly what I wanted to see, David, from this Eagle offensive line. And they are just driving Country Day's defensive front back on every play. And another thing that's interesting, too, is that really Will Fitzhugh hadn't done much on this offense. In this offense so far, had the one carry on the option pitch and he got tackled for no gain after Herring threw it to him.
Herring fakes it to Fitzhugh, put some air into this one. Got a receiver down there, intended for Graves. It's going to be incomplete. One-on-one coverage that time, kind of a 50-50 ball saw in the corner of the end zone. Graves unable to come down with it. Actually, really good coverage that time out of Metairie Park, as that was one of those that you give Landon a chance to make a play on, but well defended. It's going to bring up second down and 10.
Yeah, a little surprised there. We're trying to catch him off guard that we even went to the pass as they – but again, it's a four-down territory situation, so you still got three downs to make a first down. And I look for the Eagles to go back running the football here.
Second down and 10 for the Eagles. Two running backs in the gun with Herring. Two receivers left, one to the right. Herring's going to take this one, hands this one to Dugan. Dugan's going to bounce it outside. A little bit of running room, real close. Going to be down around the 10-yard line. And it's going to be a gain of 9, Saul. As they're going to hold the chains, it's going to bring up third and inches. Literally about a half a yard on third down here at the Metairie Park. Call it 10 yard and 6 inches line, as Herring is going to bring the Eagles to the line. Two running backs join him in the gun, two receivers to the left, one to the right. Eagles traveling from left to right. 5 minutes left to play here in the second quarter. Eagles trail 7-0. Herring, a high snap, puts this one on the ground with Fitzhugh. Fitzhugh's got the first down, trying to score. And he's going to go inside the pylon. Number 22, Will Fitzhugh, is going to take it in for the Ouachita Christian Eagle touchdown. First points of the board for the Eagles.
And there's 22 right there, David. As he does get involved in the offense, they just handed to him on a sweep to the left side, and he did a great job of sort of setting Country Day up, kind of was coasting to the inside, then at the last second sort of used his burst to get to the outside just inside the pylon for an Eagle touchdown.
Sam Harrell on to attempt the extra point. Saw the Eagles have had trouble with the snap all season long. Be interested to see what kind of zip. Again, a high snap, a slow snap, but they're able to get it placed and split the uprights as the Eagles are going to tie this football game up 7-7. A great kick that time out of Sam Harrell as he split the uprights, and we got a tie football game.
Yeah, and a better snap that time, though, Dave. It was a little bit high, but it was a lot faster coming back there than it was last week. So good job by the Eagles of working on that during the week, and a great job by the Eagles to answer that touchdown drive by Country Day after they had a real short field on the bad punt by Landon Graves. Country Day scores, and the Eagles come right back and do it in dominant fashion, just controlling the line of scrimmage and just pounding Country Day up front. And Will Fitzhugh gets the touchdown to tie this thing up.
The Will Fitzhugh touchdown run brought to you by the folks at Trinity Diamonds Direct. For all your diamond needs, visit their store located on Blanchard Street in West Monroe. All Eagle touchdowns brought to us by the folks at Trinity Diamonds Direct. Tie football game with 4 minutes and 50 seconds left to play here in the second quarter. Tie game, 7-7. Christopher Holyfield tees this one up at the 40-yard line. A low kick, and this one is going to travel out of bounds. And I will say this, Alan, unless they make us re-kick it, it's going to be about the same. It traveled out at about the 25. And I think, actually, they could take this at the 35-yard line on the penalty. So I would imagine, unless they want us to re-kick it, Metairie Park will take it first down to 10 at their own 35-yard line, and that is what they decide to do.
And, of course, Christopher Holyfield was probably the most famous out-of-bounds kick in the history of Eagle football last week against Calvary as he kicked the ball out of bounds. And Calvary certainly regrets not taking the penalty as they made us kick the ball again. And it was Julian Stevenson, the smallest man on the field, who comes down and strips the football away from Calvary's return man. And the Eagles take possession and run the clock out to get here to the semifinals with a victory over Calvary.
First down and 10 for Metairie Park Country Day. Avieta looks to throw and does. That one's going to be complete as he found number two, C.D. St. Hilaire. Hilaire kneels down to make the catch, but he does a good job going downstairs to pick it up, and it's going to be a gain of 6 yards on the play. Second down and 4 for Metairie Park. Ball at their own 39-yard line, or 41-yard line.
The Eagles choose to play a lot of coverage, David. As a result, Abiata's having a long time to throw the football. That time he could scan the field and finally finds his man for the completion.
Second 4, Abiata again looks to throw. Now he's going to pull it down and run. The Eagles are going to give up too much as he picks up 5 yards or 6 on the play, and that's going to be more than enough for a first down as Metairie Park moves the football.
Yeah, that was Michaud that missed that tackle that time. David had a chance to make a stop on him and just sort of left his feet and lunged. And you can't do that. You got to keep your feet. He's not a real shifty guy. I mean, you don't have to try to dive at him. Just stay upright and make the tackle and stop him for a short game.
Avieta in the shotgun. Eagles come with some pressure this time, and Avieta is going to throw one low, going to be complete to number 10, Daniel Conwell. And Will is going to pick up 5 yards on the play. The Eagles tried to dial up some pressure that time, Saul, but Avieta able to unload quick for the completion.
Yeah, and a great catch that time by his receivers. I mentioned in the pregame that these guys don't drop the football, David. They do an excellent job of catching the football, and you've seen it right there. That was a tough catch. It was coming hard, and it was low. Did a nice job of catching that slant.
Country Day goes to the wristbands. Avieta in the shotgun. One running back joins him in the gun. Going to fake that one, keep it himself. Avieta with some running room. Second and third effort out of the senior quarterback, and he's going to pick, only needed 5 for the first down, picked up 7, and again, the Cajuns are going to move the chains. It's going to be first down and 10 for Metairie Park at the Eagle 41-yard line. 3 minutes and 10 seconds left to play here in the first half. Seems like Saul, the clock hadn't stopped since we started this thing.
Yeah, well, there really hadn't been hardly maybe just a couple of incomplete passes by the Eagles, and one turnover and one punt. And so other than that, it just continued to run.
First down and 10 for Metairie Park. Avieta looks, throws this one out in the flat, and he's got somebody wide open. The Eagles are going to run him out of bounds on the far side of the field. But that's going to be complete to number 23 for the Cajuns. That's Christian Daly. He's going to have a gain of 14 and another first down for Metairie Park.
Yeah, the perfect play call against the blitz that time. And I don't know if it was Abieta doing that on his own, but that time the Eagles blitz from the wide side of the field, and they just run a flare route to that side. And Abieta not only throws the ball to the right person, but gives it to him in a position where he can run the ball without even having to slow up at all. And as a result, picks up a big game.
First down and 10 from Metairie Park. Ball at the Eagle, 28-yard line. 27. Avieta looks to throw. He's going to throw this one out in the flat again. He's got a wide open receiver. There's a clip, and there comes the flag. Tell you what, it looked like they may have gotten away with it there for a second, Saul, but the Eagles, big block in the back that time on Landon Graves, and that set up a really big game, but that one's going to be coming back as we've got a couple of flags on the play.
Yeah, and the Eagles were the same thing. That time they blitzed Cade Woods from the wide side, and so the running back's responsibility is to block Cade Woods, but in that case, he's just flaring out in the flat, and there's nobody there to tackle him, so it's a great way to attack a blitz. And Abiata just puts it out there again and allows him to run. And number one, Tyler Williams is the one that's going to get caught for blocking the back, and really didn't even need to do that. I don't think Cade Woods could have made the play even if he hadn't have blocked him. I think it was Landon Graves couldn't have made the play even if he hadn't have blocked him. And fortunately for the Eagles, though, this one's coming back.
They're going to mark off the penalty. Following the penalty, you're going to be looking at first down and 13. as they spot this football at the Eagle 30-yard line. 2 minutes and 19 seconds left to play here in the first half. The Cajuns, if I'm not mistaken, are going to have two timeouts to burn. First down and 13. And we've got a stoppage of play right now as we're trying to adjust the clock.
Yeah, I think the block in the back on Landon Graves, actually, Landon Graves comes up limping after that with what looks like maybe a sprained ankle. Eli Eckstein goes in the ball game for him, and looks like his job is to cover number one, Tyler Williams, which is what Landon Graves has been doing the entire ball game.
Number 13, Justin Abieta, Tulane commit. Senior, 6'5", 215-pound quarterback from Metairie Park, takes a snap, sets his feet, lets this one go. His first deep ball of the night, and that's going to be incomplete. Great coverage that time.
Great coverage by Eli Eckstein. He made perfectly covered that time. And so as we mentioned, right before that, his job was to cover Tyler Williams one-on-one. Credit Metairie Park, they see the substitution. They go right at it that time, although Eckstein, of course, has been a starter all year at cornerback, and he played it perfectly. As soon as he saw the receiver go up to catch the football, he puts his hands in there and strips it from him. Great job of execution and of not getting called for a pass interference as he played it perfectly.
Second down and 13 for the Cajuns. Clock stops with 2 minutes and 22 seconds left to play here in the first half. Tie game, 7-all. Abieta in the shotgun. Turns. He's going to call his own number. He's going to get hit in the hole this time. And they did pick up two. But it's going to bring up third down and long for the Cajuns. 2 minutes, 10 seconds left to play in the first half. Third down and 11 for Metairie Park Country Day. Ball at the Eagle 28-yard line.
Yeah, good job by Hogan that time as he wraps him up low and hangs on. You see the strength of Abieta as he's still able to carry him for a couple more yards, but good job by the Eagle defense, and especially Ethan Hogan.
Abieta in the gun. Third down and 11. Ball at the 28. Good snap. Looks to throw. Unloads this one, and that one's going to be incomplete. Almost intercepted. If it would have been a good pass, maybe somebody there, but saw it's going to bring up fourth down and 11 for Metairie Park. And if their previous possessions are any indication, they're going to go for this.
Yeah, and Ethan Hogan with the pressure that time as he blitzes up the middle. And Abieta threw it. He actually threw it before the receiver even came out of his break and just wasn't able to step into the throw. And as a result, not able to get the ball out there where he needed to for the completion.
Well, the Cajuns are electing to take a timeout here. Clock stopped with 1:39 left to play here in the first half. But the Cajuns want to think about this one. It's a big fourth down play. We're going to take this opportunity to go down to our man on the sideline, Coach Sonny Vadreen with the Marion State Bank sideline report. Coach, pretty good game going on down there.
It really is. I tell you what, it's going to be a game of very few opportunities and very few possessions the way the clock's running, because they're not no incomplete passes, hardly, and everything's running. I mean, the clock's just running and running, so you got to really make good on all the opportunities that you got. Right now, we're doing a good job on defense. We just got to have one more good play right here, and maybe we get a chance to run our two-minute offense and get a score before the half.
Thanks a lot. Coach Sonny Vadreen with the Marion State Bank sideline report. What do you like on fourth down if you're the Cajun coach here, Saul?
Well, I don't know what their offense is, Dan, but I tell you what I like about the Eagle defense. That's like putting some pressure on Abieta and making sure you got somebody spying him and not letting him run to his first down. But he likes to throw it equally to his four guys. You know, Tyler Williams is his main receiver, but he'll scan the field. And they do a lot of vertical routes, David, where they all four go vertical. The Eagle's going to play two deep zone right here. And that opens up the middle of the field, so got to watch for that.
Fourth down and 11 for Metairie Park Country Day. Abieta takes a snap from center. Looks. Going to pull this one down. He's got some running room. He's going to fake out a couple of Eagle defenders, and he's going to be run out of bounds way more than they needed to give up. Going to pick up it's tough to tell exactly where they spot this football, but had a couple of chances to make a play, Saul, but Abieta is very capable with his legs as well as his arm. You had said he was one of their leading, if not their leading rusher. That time he picks up 18 yards, needed 11 for the first down. So 1 minute, 30 seconds left to play here in the first half. Clock stops, Abieta run out of bounds. First and goal for the Cajuns. Abieta steps into this one, and no indication, but now they're going to say touchdown. Cajuns.
Touchdown, Cajuns.
Abietta is going to find his favorite receiver. That's number one, Tyler Williams, and he'll take it in for the touchdown.
Yeah, Will fits you on the coverage that time, just not tight enough. I mean, he had pretty good coverage, but you got to be on them tight against these guys when they throw that slant, especially on the goal line like that. And I mentioned they just don't drop the football, and Abietta puts it right on the money. And, man, just a backbreaker when you let him pick up 18 yards for the first down. And, you know, you just got to be able to be more disciplined than that. And Eagles and a couple of guys a chance to tackle him on that long gain and just didn't do a good job.
Number 22, Andrew Lopez on for the extra point. Looked like Eckstein was close, Saul, but it's going to just sneak by his outstretched arm as the Cajuns take a lead 14-7. Having said that, the Eagles with a full complement of timeouts. I believe they've got three here. A minute, 23 seconds, and the Cajuns are going to have to kick the football to a very dangerous return man in Will Fitzhugh.
Man, it'd be big to get some points on the board before halftime, especially considering you're going to get the football back to start the second half. And that's what you want to do somehow, is to get an extra possession, just like it was kind of like that last week. You know, you had to find that possession in order to finally get in front, and that's what you got to do here, because it's the Country Day has shown that it's going to be very, very hard to stop them and keep them out of the end zone.
Eagles are going to send Will Fitzhugh deep. Minute and 23 seconds left to play here in the second quarter. Eagles, if I'm not mistaken, Saul, do have a full complement of three timeouts to close out the half. Eagles send Landon Graves and Will Fitzhugh deep. Eckstein is going to stand about the 35-yard line. If the pass kick was any indication, Saul, Lopez killed it. Sent it about 10 yards deep into the end zone. No opportunity for a return. Will Fitzhugh is going to stand on the goal line. Landon Graves is going to stand about the 10. And Lopez puts it in play. It's going to be a low line drive kick. It's going to bounce. Will's going to have a chance for the return. Picks it up at the 20. He's across the 30 before he's upended. And so the Eagles will start, in all likelihood, their first drive of the last drive of the second half. Gain of 17 on the return. It's going to be first down and 10 for the Eagles at their own 32-yard line. A minute and 18 seconds left to play in the half.
Yeah, going to have to throw the football on this drive, David. You know, we've been so successful running the football, but only had two opportunities this half with the possession. It's just been such a quick half. And so the Eagles now, and Hunter Herring are going to take over here with hopefully a chance to put some points on the football on the scoreboard before the end of this first half.
First down and 10, Herring in the shotgun. Four receivers, part of the set. Sends Fitzhugh in motion across the formation. Good snap from center. Herring rolls, looking to throw. Pulls it down, puts some air into this one, and that's going to be incomplete. Not even really in the vicinity that time, so always looking to look like for Tristan Wiley, and that was just way overthrown.
Yeah, pretty good coverage that time, David. It'd have been tough to squeeze that one in there, and he may have thrown that over his head on purpose.
It's going to be second down and 10 for the Eagles. Ball at their own 32-yard line. A minute, 12 seconds left to play here in the first half. Eagles trail 14-7. Herring in the shotgun. Three receivers to his left, one to his right. Turns, puts this one in the air quickly out to Wiley. Wiley's across the 30, across the 35 before he's upended, and it looks like the Eagles are going to have to burn a timeout as it'll bring up third down and 6 for the Eagles. And they do not take a timeout.
Yeah, I wouldn't take one here, David. You certainly don't want to give them the ball back if you don't pick up the first down here. And there's an example of Hunter Herring not being very accurate right there, as he was going to throw a tunnel screen to Tristan Wiley and made him have to come back for the football, and as a result, lost all his momentum.
And the Eagles decide to keep this one on the ground. They're going to keep it on the ground with Dugan. Dugan is going to fight forward for yardage, gain of 5 yards, but he's going to be short. And it looks like the Cajuns are going to take their final time out of the half and try to get their hands on the football with 34 seconds left to play here in the second quarter. Eagles trail 14-7.
Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, let's go down to the sideline and catch up with Coach Sonny Vedrine. Coach, making it tough in this half, huh?
Yeah, that play was designed. He should have stayed outside on that play, and I think he could have got a lot more yard. He broke it back inside a little too quick on that play. This is a big play here where you think you run a run freeze play, maybe, and try to go a cowboy standing in the saddle, maybe jump him offside, get a first down. If not, you just run the clock down or, you know, run it down and then have to punt it or whatever. 5 more yards on a punt really won't make that much difference here, but maybe you get a chance to get them jump offside.
All right, thanks a lot, Coach. Coach Sonny Vedrine with the Marion State Bank sideline reports. All you and I have seen the Eagles be very successful, even on punts, with drawing teams offsides. Maybe they'll give it a try here, but looks like Hunter Herring is actually still on the field at 4th and 3.
Yeah, looks like they're thinking about going for it. I'm not sure that I agree with this, but as Coach said, they may just be trying to draw them offsides.
Herring lines up in the shotgun. 3 receivers to the left. Going to send a man in motion. That's Fitzhugh. Herring checks out of it. Not sure if they're going to run a play or not. Play clock down to 10. Eagles go down in a stance. Nobody jumps, so Herring is going to have to let the play clock wind down and burn a timeout. So they do try to go steady in the saddle, and the Cajuns don't fall for it, Saul. So now you're going to be looking at 4th and 3, and the Eagles, I would imagine, are going to punt this football.
Yeah,
need a good punt this time.
Yeah, really need a good punt off right here. It's, again, Landon Graves, it's not been typical of him throughout the year. He's been averaging right at 34 yards a punt. And the first just kind of kicked off the side of his foot. They really had no pressure on him as well. And so a good punt here is of the utmost importance, as we definitely need to keep them out of the end zone before the end of this first half.
Timeout taken that time by the Eagles with 34 seconds left to play here in the second quarter. It does not look like the Eagles are going to do it again.
Of course, we have another timeout. So
possible to draw him off here again, but Herring and the Eagle offense are on the field. An eye backfield beside Herring in the shotgun. 4th down and 3. Ball at the Eagle 40-yard line. Again, Herring looks like he's checking out of it. And again, we'll stand at the 35-yard line. Eagles go down, and again, they try to draw Country Day offsides. And again, now the Eagles have burned their final timeout. And I don't think Metairie Park was going to fall for that one, so it seemed like basically the same thing over again.
Yeah, it was a good try, and I guess Coach Fitzhugh thought, you can't use those timeouts in the second half, so might as well give it another shot at it and call another timeout.
Why not?
Now they're going to punt it, I feel sure.
Well, again, we'd like to take an opportunity to thank the folks over at Forsyth Avenue Church of Christ. Ouachita Christian Football is presented in part by Forsyth Avenue Church of Christ. Sunday worship service beginning at 10 a.m., followed by Bible class at 11:10 a.m. You can find Forsyth Avenue Church of Christ on Facebook or at facoc.org. Forsyth Church of Christ, proud longtime supporters of Ouachita Christian Eagle football, and I'd like to send a shout out to the minister over at Forsyth, John Dobbs. Know he's tuned in tonight. And again, like to thank the folks at Forsyth Avenue Church of Christ. 4th down, and again, saw the Eagle offense. Again, the Eagle offense is on the field. This time they send Fitzhugh in motion. Herring's going to call for the football. They're going to keep this one on the ground, and they're going to have a 1st down, and then some. Clock continues to run now inside of 20 seconds. Gain of 7 yards on the play. I don't know, man. So maybe they just
say about that. If you're going to go for it, you might as well go for it at the beginning and save all your timeouts.
Well, Coach Fitzhugh is trying to get somebody off the field, and he will. Herring is going to line up in the shotgun. 20 seconds left to play. Dugan joins him in the gun. Good snap from center. Herring looks to throw. Pump fake. Now he's dialing it up. He's looking for Will Fitzhugh, and that one's going to be incomplete. Giving Will an opportunity that time. Well covered. Actually, double covered that time. So 10 seconds left to play here in the first half. Second down.
Yeah, good coverage that time by Country Day. And Fitzhugh tried to go up and make the catch, but a good job by the Country Day free safety coming over and helping knock that ball down.
2nd down and 10 for the Eagles. 10 seconds left to play here in the first half. Herring lines up in the shotgun. Dugan joins him in the gun. 2 receivers left, 2 to his right. Herring, little pressure. He's going to throw this one, and that one's going to be complete to Wiley. He's going to hand it back to Will Fitzhugh. Fitzhugh's going to have a 1st down, and that's going to bring it in to the first half of play as the Eagles burned all 3 timeouts, Saul, and as a result,
I think they're going to have another play, David. The clock went out, but that was actually a double reverse. They threw the ball to Wiley, who pitched it backwards to Fitzhugh, who then pitched it backwards again to Eckstein, and then gets tackled out of bounds. And I think they're going to say there may be 3 seconds left on the play clock.
There are 3 seconds, and it looks like Metairie Park may have burned their final timeout to adjust some things, as they're bringing on, they're actually bringing their quarterback in, Saul. And I got to tell you, probably a pretty smart play is Ibieta goes 6'5", and it looks like the Eagles are probably going to be trying some form of a Hail Mary. Speaking from watching him, and I know you have as well, Hunter Herring has no issue with throwing the football to the end zone from here.
Yeah, well, of course, they're on about the 34-yard line, so it's not that long of a throw. And, you know, got to think that not sure if they'll try to put three guys on one side and just throw it up and see if they can maybe a deflection. Or, you know, 35 yards out, you can try to run something maybe down the middle of the field, see if you can get a catch and run. But a lot of opportunities because of that last play, getting the Eagles a little bit closer with a chance to maybe get something on the board here.
Country Day is going to stand at the 10-yard line with their deep defensive backs, basically inviting the Eagles to put this one in the air. Herring going to take a snap at the 38-yard line. Going to send Graves in motion across the formation. He gets a good snap, and he's got some time. Now he's feeling a little bit of pressure, but he'll roll out and launch one. Looking downfield. It's going to be caught! It's caught by Eckstein! Eckstein hauls it in the end zone! And this crazy 2019 season continues to roll on!
What a great job, first of all, by Hunter Herring of getting away from the pressure. There's a little pressure inside. He rolls to the right, and Eckstein was streaking across the middle of the field in the back of the end zone. Country Day came across with a chance to knock it down and just mistimed their jump or misjudged how high the ball was, and it gets over his hand and hits Eckstein on the dead run in the back of the end zone.
Big extra point attempt here for Harrell. Sam Harrell on the snap. The kick, it squeaked through. Got it through, and the Eagles are going to tie this football game at half.
Well, I tell you what, how big was that play, the trick play, with the double lateral to get the Eagles down there and get out of bounds just in time to allow us to run another play. And then the Eagles with perfect execution at the end of that ball game. And, you know, got to credit Coach Fitzhugh for dialing up the right play calls to get this team on the board and completely change the complexion of this ball game. I mean, it was going to be all Country Day with Everybody momentum agree. Going into the first into halftime. And now the Eagles with momentum, maybe feeling a little bit invincible, David, after what happened last week, and feeling a little bit maybe like there's some magic on this.
Well, there
Eagles
might be.
Line,
there
right?
might be. You mentioned it just a little while ago, Saul. You said you're going to have to turn it over. You know, you got to change the script. That touchdown, now the Eagles with a chance to get the ball in the second half, and the Eagles with a chance to take the lead in the contest tonight. But a great great play right before the half as Eli Eckstein takes it in from Hunter Herring. We're going to take a break from here at Eagles Stadium. Want to invite you to come back and join us for the Rocket Fast Car Wash halftime show. The Ouachita Christian Eagles in a dogfight tonight, 14-14, with Metairie Park Country Day at the half. You're listening to Ouachita Christian Eagle Football on 92.3 The Wolf. Eagle Stadium, campus of Ouachita Christian School. The Ouachita Christian Eagles hosting the Metairie Park Country Day Cajuns. And it's tied up 14-14. A heck of a football game going on out here at Eagle Stadium tonight. As the Eagles hosting Metairie Park in the quarterfinals of the semifinals of the Division IV Louisiana High School Athletic Association playoffs. And we have seen and been a part of a heck of a football game so far tonight. And I'm going to take a chance to go down to a former Ouachita Christian defensive coordinator, Coach Sonny Vadreen with the Marion State Bank sideline report. And Coach, if the first half is any indication, I think we're in for a whale of a football game.
It sure looks that way. I'll tell you what, you can't have any missed possessions in this game because you're not getting a whole lot of them like we talked about. And the guys seem to be doing a good job. That last play was just phenomenal to get that last play in like we did. And just tie the score 14. Now we get the ball to beginning of the third quarter. And, you know, that's a good position. If we can go up 7 points, we can change the complexion of the game because they'll make them start doing a few things. Defensively, we got to make a few adjustments, though, David. We got to come out and be able to cover the back out of the backfield and put more pressure on the quarterback and be better tacklers. If we can do those two things, I think we're in good shape because we had them on 4th and 18 and we had them on 3rd and 20 and we let each one of those plays get away from us, which would have been big stops and would stop one touchdown from scoring. So if we can do those kind of things, I think we're going to be in good shape starting off the second half.
the first half of play. And I tell you what, he has been, at least, you know, from what we've seen so far tonight, he's been the difference maker for Metairie Park Country Day.
Yeah, and we knew he was going to be the difference maker. You know, I mean, he's rushed for 2,300 yards in his career. And, you know, the Eagles had chances at him, and that's why he's so good. I mean, you know, the people that are good, they don't go down easily, and that's what he does. And the Eagles spent a lot of time in halftime trying to make some defensive adjustments on tackling him in the open field. And the big play is what hurt us. We had, you know, two times where we had him in long yarded situations, and he's able to come up with the big run for the first down to keep the drive alive. And on fourth down, on their last touchdown, he was able to get the first down and then ultimately throw the slant route to Williams for the touchdown.
Fourth and 18, able to come up with it.
Yeah, just a great job by him. He's so poised back there in the pocket, and you know, just does a great job of scanning the field. And then, you know, the receivers catch the ball well. And we said it at the beginning of the broadcast, they're going to move the football. There's no question about it. And it's just a matter of you've got to try to keep them out of the end zone. When that field is squeezed down and there's not as much room for those routes to, you know, what happens is in the middle field, they're running all these different route combinations. They put your defense in a bind, and he's so good at picking out the open receiver. But when you get inside that 20-yard line and those things shrink, that's the time that you've got to make plays and keep them out of the end zone. And the Eagles were able to do it on the first drive and come up with an interception, but have not been able to stop them since. So, you know, credit the Eagles for coming up with a heroic touchdown to end the half and get themselves back in this ball game, and now with a lot of momentum and a chance to come out here and take the lead to start the second half.
Well, we're about a minute from getting the second half underway. The score here at Eagle Stadium is 14-14. We're going to take our final break of the half and invite everybody to join us back here at Eagle Stadium for the second half of play tonight. You're listening to Ouachita Christian Eagle Football on 92.3 The Wolf. Eagle Stadium, the campus of Ouachita Christian School. The Ouachita Christian Eagles hosting the Cajuns from Metairie Park Country Day in tonight's Division IV semifinal playoff contest.
David, they got a few scores here. Of course, they've only been playing football for 14 minutes in these other places, but do have some early scores. Zachary and Rustin tied up at 7 in the first quarter. Western Road Destrehan still scoreless. Neville was on top of Westgate 3-0 early, and Lakeshore leads Bastrop 7-0.
Well, get an early start tonight. Again, the Eagles kicked off tonight's contest at 6:00, trying to give the folks from Metairie Park a little jump on their travel time home. I want to thank everybody for tuning into the Rocket Fast Car Wash Halftime Show. Visit Rocket Fast today. Rocket Fast, it's a blast. As we get ready to get the second half underway, Eagles won the coin toss, deferred. They get the ball to start the second half. As the Cajuns put it in play, it's going to be a sky kick. Nobody out in the middle of the field for the Eagles. But Eckstein is going to drift over. He's going to come up with a big play. He's across the 50. He's across the 40. Still moving his feet. Now he's inside the 30. He's going to be upended at the 25-yard line. Great play that time out of the senior wide receiver, number 15, Eli Eckstein. A real heads-up play that time, Saul. A senior play as he goes over and gets a ball. It gets upfield and makes a chunk of yardage. Gain of 47 on the return. First down and 10 for the Eagles at the Metairie Park Country Day 27-yard line. Hunter Herring with the ball, first and 10 at the 27. The Eagles opening drive of the second half. Herring in the shotgun, two receivers to his left. Going to keep this one on the ground. That's Dugan. Dugan tough sledding inside, but is going to get down inside the Randall's Fine Meat red zone at the 20-yard line. Gain of 7 on the play.
Yeah, the Eagles finally able to run their offense again. It seems like forever that we've seen them kind of get out there with a chance to run the football. And a good job on first down again of that offensive line just imposing their will on their defensive line, and a nice run by Dugan.
Second and 3 again with Dugan. Dugan's going to bounce, cuts it back inside, going to be real close to a first down, needed 3, and they're going to give him four, and that's going to be another community pharmacy first down.
And that was actually Will Fitzhugh who carried that football, David. A nice cut by him to get upfield for the first down. Actually stumbled a little bit. I think he would have gotten more out of it, but again, great job by the offensive line up front, opening up a hole for Will Fitzhugh.
First down of 10 for the Eagles. Fitzhugh and Dugan in the backfield. Again, they go with Fitzhugh. Fitzhugh is going to bounce it outside, cuts it back inside the 10, the 5, touchdown! Ouachita Christian! Number 22, Will Fitzhugh, is going to take it in from 16 yards out. And another Trinity Diamonds direct touchdown.
And another good cut by Fitzhugh as he runs to the outside. And the offensive line was sort of sealing their people, their defenders on the outside, and Fitzhugh couldn't get out to the outside where the play was designed to go, and he cuts it back upfield, finds a seam, and gets in the end zone for a touchdown.
And that's the score flips. All you had talked about right before the half is the Eagles now go out in front and take the lead. Harrell on for the extra point, and that one is no good. And that is a critical kick that's going to slip away.
Yeah, and
the Eagles now with a lead 20-14.
That loses your advantage a little bit now, David, because, you know, the Country Day is very good in the kicking game. And so now you give them the score, they can go ahead. But, again, a great job by the Eagles in that opening drive, and an excellent job by Eli Eckstein on the kickoff return. It was a tough kick to field as the ball was – they tried to just sort of kick it in an open lane, and Eckstein didn't panic. He waited for the ball to bounce up in the air and goes and picks it up and then is able to run. Almost broke it for the touchdown, but an excellent return to give the Eagles great field position to start that drive, and they just pound the ball into the end zone really at will against Country Day. Nice job to come out this second half and with a big drive and take the lead.
Eagles start the second half exactly as they wanted to, with the exception of missing the extra point attempt. In a game like this time of the year, you never know when it can come back to haunt you. Hopefully, this Eagle defense won't even have to worry about it. Christopher Holyfield tees it up at the 40-yard line and gets ready to give the Cajuns their first possession of the night. A good kick, fielded cleanly. Now it's dropped at about the 10-yard line by the Cajuns. And that's going to be number 10 on the return, and he is going to be dropped. Great coverage that time by the Eagles. Saw a great kick by Holyfield as Conwell unable to handle it, and he's going to lose 2 yards on the return. It looks like it's going to bring up first down. They'll spot this at the 12-yard line of the Cajuns.
It's hard to give any one person credit on that tackle, Dave, is Julian Stevenson, Cale Skipper, and Cade Woods all met him at the same time. And just a great job by Julian Stevenson of getting down the football field. And again, he's the hero of the game last week with his strip on the kickoff return, forced fumble to be able to seal that win for the Eagles.
Ibieta is going to take this one, throws this one underneath, and it's going to be complete to number one. So it looked like maybe a version of the tunnel screen as he found Williams that time on a slant. Gain of 3 yards on the play, going to bring up second down and 7.
That's the way you play the tunnel screen that time, Dave. They did a good job of blocking Landon Green as the tackle comes out and blocks him. But Fitzhugh, it looks like maybe Cade Woods or Michaud were able to get in there and tackle him for a really short gain.
Second down and 7. For the Cajuns, Ibieta in the shotgun. Ball at their own 15-yard line. Ibieta's going to try it himself, and now he's going to get back to the line of scrimmage and no more. Well, Donnie gives him a yard, and that's because he fell forward for it, but it's going to bring up a big third down play here for the Eagles on the opening drive of the second half for Metairie Park Country Day. It's going to be third down and 5. 9 minutes and 53 seconds left to play here in the third quarter. Eagles lead 20-14.
The Eagles going to put an extra defensive back in the game right now. Right now they've got 6 defensive backs in the ball game as they pull out John Thomas Dixon.
Ibieta looks to throw. Now he feels some pressure, and they're going to collapse the pocket and hold him. They're going to have to punt this one, though, Saul. Gain of 1 yard on the play. It's going to bring up 4th down and 4 for Metairie Park, and they are going to send the punting team on the field.
You know, coming to this ball game, David, I thought that the weakness of this Eagle team was their pass coverage. But so far tonight, their pass coverage has been tremendous. I mean, none of these receivers are running wide open. Ibieta has had nowhere to go. And the difference in the first half, though, is when he pulled it down, he was getting big gains. Well, that time, the Eagles make a great adjustment, and they're able to stop him short of the first down.
The Eagles are going to have to take a timeout here. A little bit of confusion on some substitutions, getting people in and out. And, boy, that could be a very valuable timeout this time of the year, Saul, as the Eagles burn one on special teams. but it's still going to remain fourth and five or fourth and four for the Cajuns. 9 minutes left to play here in the third quarter.
Yeah, they had to burn it that time, David, because it looked like they had too many men on the field. And if you get that penalty, it's a first down for Country Day. And not sure what happened. Coach Fitchu was talking it over with some of his assistant coaches on the sideline, and he was not very happy. So something there was a mistake from the coaching staff, I believe, on that particular play. And Eagles get it corrected now, but have to burn a timeout to do it.
Well, it's very rare that you see Coach Fitchu without a hat or a headset. And there for a few seconds, he had neither. 9 minutes left to play here in the third quarter. The Eagles lead 20-14. First drive of the second half, the Eagles put points on the board. Set up on the heels of a great kickoff return by Eli Eckstein. Fourth down and four. Punter for the Cajuns is going to stand at his 5-yard line. Will Fitchu is going to stand at his 40. It's a low kick, and now we're going to have no flag. Really unusual, Saul, but we still have no flag. And I tell you, it's a huge break that time for the Eagles. May have been a little acting job there by number 13.
I can't believe they didn't call it. Unless they're saying maybe he tipped it, but he didn't signal that. But I have no idea why they didn't call it. It looked like it was Michaud that was going into it. Unless he blocked the man into the punter first. That would be, if he blocks the up back into the punter first, then I imagine he can make contact as well. But the Eagles very fortunate, and the white hat was looking right at it and decided not to make the call. So it could have easily been a rough in the punter right there. Even if it was just running into the punter, it would have been a first down.
First down and 10 for the Eagles. Herring calls for the ball, keeps this one on the ground with Fitchu. Fitchu's already getting the ground game going early. Now we're going to have a penalty marker. Huge gain that time, Saul, but you know it's coming back as the official almost immediately threw the flag, and he got us for holding. Well, maybe a makeup call there, but man, that flag came out in an instant, really before Will even got his shoulder square, but it's going to cost the Eagles 10 yards from the spot of the foul, and that's going to be a big penalty as it'll back them up inside their own 20-yard line. It's going to bring up first down and 20 now, it looks like.
Boy, this is an important drive right here, David. You could just change this ball game if you could go up by two scores. And really, the only thing that's been able to stop the Eagles tonight has been a penalty. As the very first drive of the ball game, when we were deep inside our own territory, they held us to 3-and-out. But since that time, they've not been able to do anything with our offense.
This drive starts behind the sticks. Huge penalty on first down. First and 20 for the Eagles. Herring's going to pull this one down himself. Now he's looking for running room. Cuts it back inside. Runs over a Metairie Park defender. And it's going to be a gain of 9 on the play. Saul got a lot of it back. It's going to bring up second down and 11 at the Eagle 26-yard line.
Yeah, really good play there on first down and long. And Herring, as you mentioned, gets it almost back to the original line of scrimmage. A good run by him, as it looked like Metairie Park had a chance to have that thing hemmed up. And they're probably a little frustrated, just like we get frustrated, as they couldn't tackle our quarterback either.
Keep this one on the ground with Dugan. Dugan's going to bust inside the tackles. Tough run that time by Dugan. Solly, they had him hemmed up for no gain, but he squirts through and picks up 5 yards. A nice tough run in between the tackles for Dylan Dugan.
Yeah, a little spin move that time, as you're right. He was hemmed up behind the left side of the offensive line, and then he spun back to the inside and picks up an extra 3 yards.
Third down and 6. Huge third down. Saul, you alluded to it. If you keep this thing moving, third down and 6 here, it'd be a great job, great opportunity to pull ahead of this game. Herring in the shotgun, an eye backfield beside him, keeps this one on the ground, keeps his legs churning. He's got a first down and a bonus yard to boot. Another Community Pharmacy first down. Needed 5, picked up 7. First down and 10 for the Eagles.
You know, there was a quote in the paper this week, David, from the Calvary Baptist head coach, just said these guys just kept wearing us down. They were relentless, and that's what you see with this Eagle offensive line and these backs, is they just pound you. They run downhill in every play, and you saw it there.
First down and 10. They keep this one on the ground with Dugan. Great kickout block that time by Fitchu. Dugan finally gets the corner. Nice, tough run that time out of Dylan Dugan. Saul Dugan has gotten better every week. He runs tough. He runs hard, and that time picked up 6 yards, going to set the Eagles up with second down and 4.
Yeah, I just was about to say the same thing, David. He has gotten better every week, and this is the best I've seen him run the football this year. And boy, nice job of running the football. And again, you mentioned a good kickout block. I think that was Fitzhugh who was able to kick out and get and Dugan comes right in behind him and picks up a nice gain again on first down.
Herring in the shotgun, two running backs with him in the gun. Again, they give this one to Dugan. Again, he's got a seam. Real patient run that time. Going to be real close to a first down, depending on where they spot this football. It looks like where the officials are set up now, it will be enough, and it is. Another Community Pharmacy first down as the Eagles keep the chains moving.
I like what Dugan did that time. They thought he was going to cut it inside, but he just got on Fitzhugh's back and just kind of put his hand on Fitzhugh's back and just followed that guy that was blocking for those extra 2 yards to pick up the first down.
First down and 10 for the Eagles. Ball at their own 49-yard line. Again, they go with Dugan, and again, this time he's going to get upended. Great play that time, Saul, out of number one for the Cajuns, Tyler Williams, and he minimizes the gain. Going to be a gain of two, but it's going to set up second and eight.
Yeah, it's the second time in a row they've run that zone read, and I'd look for them to, next time they run it, to look at Hunter Herring pull that football inside and keep it inside.
Second down and eight for the Eagles. Ball in Cajun territory at the 49. Herring in the shotgun, looks to keep this one himself. He's across the 50, across the 45, and he's going to move the chains again with another Community Pharmacy first down as Herring takes it across the 40-yard line, a gain of 10 yards, needed eight, and that's going to be another Eagle first down. First down and 10 at the Cajun 39-yard line.
And after that play, Will Fitzhugh looked to the sideline and sort of gave it the let's keep running this play over and over again because they don't have an answer for it.
Clock continues to run, 5:20. Now they keep this one to Dugan. Dugan with a seam. Dugan's across the 20, down inside the 15, the 10, before he's dropped. Ball comes out way late, and that's going to be more than enough for another Community Pharmacy first down as the Eagles set up shop inside the Randall's Fine Meat red zone, a gain of 31 yards on the play.
Boy, just a nice burst that time by Dugan. And again, the offensive line is continuing to just blow open holes on this Country Day defensive front, and Dugan breaks it into the secondary for a long run. The Eagles coming with a power formation now, two tight ends, and actually running an unbalanced line to the left side of this formation.
First down and goal at the 8-yard line. Herring calls his own number down inside the 10, the 5, touchdown, Ouachita Christian. Number 11, Hunter Herring, is going to take it in for the score, and the Eagles increase their lead.
They're going to stay in that same formation, David, and run a two-point conversion. And again, they could probably run any play they want to down there. I said the same thing last week against Calvary. That was just as physical a run as you could have right there, is everybody was just blowing people off the ball. And then not only that, but when the defender for Country Day tries to come up and tackle Hunter Herring in the end zone, he just runs right over him.
Eagles lead is 26-14. Big, big two-point conversion play here. Herring is going to keep it himself. Now he's going to have to bounce it outside, and he gets in for the two-point conversion. Eagles lead 28-14. Number 11 putting it on his shoulders. Takes it in for the two-point conversion.
And I thought he'd made a mistake that time, Davis. It looked like he could have kept it inside, but he bounced it to the outside, and Tyler Williams comes up and dives for him and hits his ankles, and Hunter's just kind of somehow, some way, able to keep his knees off the ground and dive into the end zone for the two-point conversion.
Physical drive, Saul, a physical drive as the Eagles push the ball down the field. You had hinted towards or said, hey, you know, they could run the same thing for the two-point conversion. That's exactly what they did as Herring goes in, and the Eagles increase their lead now 28-14. 4 minutes and 56 seconds left to play here in the third quarter.
Boy, just a great statement drive that time, David. You go back to when they had it third and long after the penalty, or third and about four or five, and Eagles able to convert on the Hunter Herring carry inside, and that just set them up. Now, after they've been pushed back because of the penalty, then they got back on the right side of the chains, and it was just no stopping them after that as they took the football down the field, just running it down Country Day's throat. However, we've seen this story before about 5 years ago, and
we
just got to keep playing because Country Day is certainly capable of coming back in this football game.
Christopher Holyfield gets his leg into it. It's a nice kick. It's going to travel down inside the 15-yard line. Going to be taken on the return, and again, the cardinal sin of kickoff returns is running sideways And that time, again, number 10, Saul, that's actually Daniel Conwell. And Will Conwell is going to pick up 9 yards on the play. But good job of coverage that time by the Eagles special teams as the Cajuns start this drive, first and 10 at their own 21-yard line.
And that was John Thomas Dixon who makes the tackle that time, and a good tackle by him as the Eagles, again, force Country Day into some poor field position because of excellent special teams play.
Abietta takes this one, hands this one off to his running back, and the Eagles are stoning him inside. Tough running inside. Donnie's going to give him a gain of 3 yards. As they pick up 3, and so you're gonna be looking at second down now and 7 as they put this football at the Country Day 25-yard line.
Well, and Country Day certainly had a commitment to the running game tonight, David. I'm surprised at it because they really have had no success. Other than Abietta running the football, they've had no success than anybody else running it.
Second down and 7. Abietta pulls this one down, throws it out in the flat. Now they're going to try a trick play, and he's got a man wide open. As they're going to give chase, but that one's going to go to Tyler Williams, who's in for the touchdown. And not an Eagle defender within 20 yards of him as the Eagles fall victim to the old double pass.
He had a big mistake by Will Fitchew that time, as he's the one that got burned. They threw the pass to the right side of the formation, and he came up on the outside, and there was nobody back there. It was his job to stay deep, and he got a little too aggressive, and you got to credit Country Day's coaching staff for making the play call. And there, it's an excellent coaching staff, David, as we saw 4 or 5 years ago, whenever that was, we played last time, and you knew they weren't going to quit. And just a great play call that time to turn this momentum back a little bit to the Country Day side.
Well, we've got a stoppage of play as Country Day lines up.
It's going to be an offside against the Eagles.
Call goes against the Eagles.
So they'll be penalized half the distance to the goal for an extra point attempt, which I can assure you that half a yard will make no difference to Andrew Lopez. Lopez with a strong leg. So he's killed these extra points, and he's done a great job of kicking off for the Cajuns as well. The last one was a sky kick that the Eagles were able to turn into a big play. But Lopez on to cut this lead to 7 for the Eagles. Gets his leg into it. Now Eckstein's going to pop him for good measure. And
get him again for running to the kicker.
Running into the kicker is exactly what happened. I don't think it's going to be the roughing variety, so we don't have a signal from the official yet. The extra point attempt is good.
Lopez while ago is unlike most kickers.
No, it's going to be a personal foul. And he barely got his foot.
Yeah, well, what I noticed with Lopez is that most kickers, when they kick the ball, they kind of stay in one spot if they kick it. Once he kicks it, he sort of scoots forward, almost catapults himself forward, and it's almost impossible to put your body in position to block the kick without roughing him. So the only chance you've got is to either hit the ball, and if you hit the ball, they won't count it as roughing, because if you don't touch the ball, you're going to hit him every single time. And actually, the last kick he had, we ran into him there as well. They just didn't call it.
Well, it's going to be, 21 now with the extra point to 28. Eagles lead by 7. 4 minutes left to play here in the third quarter. And this third quarter, Saul's taken a lot longer than the first two. As with the penalty, Metairie Park is going to kick this football from the Eagle 45-yard line. And I can assure Eagle fans, Lopez did not need the yardage to kick this into the end zone. But now you could be looking at the potential for an onside kick.
Yeah, absolutely. I guarantee you that. Well, maybe not the way he's setting up now. Doesn't look like he's going to do that.
Well, maybe he's setting up like that, so we don't think he's going to do it, and the Eagles don't think he's going to do it. But it could be one of those slow dribblers right down the middle. But the Eagles are anticipating it. Saw everybody within 15 yards of the ball. Lopez is going to take a short run up, and he's going to kick a directional kick. It's going to be fielded cleanly by Fitzhugh at about the 5-yard line. He's across the 10, across the 20. Ball came out, and the Eagles are unbelievably fortunate that Eli Eckstein was able to jump on it. First time I've seen Fitzhugh put it on the ball put it on the ground all season, Saul, but he lost the handle. And the Eagles, very fortunate, the heads-up play by the senior Eli Eckstein, as the Eagles now set up this drive, first down and 10, at their own 18-yard line.
And Fitzhugh comes out. Looks like maybe he had a stinger or something. He was holding his arm kind of awkwardly. That may be why he dropped the football.
Herring is going to be joined in the backfield by Eckstein and Dugan. Two receivers to his left, one to his right. A good snap from center. They give this one to Dugan. Dugan with a tough run inside, but boy, Metairie Park stiffened that time. Gain of 2 yards. Really tough for Dugan to get going on it. He does, but it's going to bring up second down and 8.
And again, Metairie Park Country Day with some life now on their sideline. Their fans kind of up, getting going after that big touchdown on the trick play. And the Eagles got to answer here again because, again, you don't want to give it back to them with the chance to tie this ball game.
Second down and 8. Ball at the 20-yard line. 3 minutes and 30 seconds left to play in the third quarter. Eagles lead 28-21. Herring in the shotgun, Fitzhugh and Dugan. Turns. Fitzhugh with a great block that time. Dugan is going to try to bounce it. Saul bounced it right into the block. And that will get him back to the line of scrimmage and no more. You're looking now at a huge third down and 8 play here.
Yeah, and a good job that time by Tyler Williams. Is that, you know, the Eagles have gone to that play a couple of times, and he did a great job of stringing Dugan out. And they had some good inside. The linebackers coming from the inside, able to keep Dugan from turning it back up the field. And so a nice job by Country Day at the time of stopping the run.
Third down and 8. Maybe third and 9, actually. A loss on the play. Herring is going to send Fitzhugh in motion out of the backfield. Herring looks to throw. Puts this one in Fitzhugh's hands. He's going to have to make an outside defender miss, and he does. Continues to move the football, but he's going to be short of the first down. And that's going to bring up fourth down and 2 for the Eagles, and in all likelihood going to bring out the punt team.
Yeah, I would think they would punt here, David. Although with the way we've run the football and the way Country Day also can throw the football, you're tempted to go for it here. But it looks like Coach Fitzhugh is going to do what's probably the smart thing and punt this football.
Probably, Saul, if you could get on the other side of the 40, you would, but you'd hate to give them a short field here as the Eagles have it 4th and 2 at their own 25-yard line. Landon Graves' last punt covered 14 yards. Hopefully, he'll get into this one. And now the Eagles are going to take their second time out of the half. And I don't know if it's a substitution issue or what's going on here, but the Eagles are going to burn a timeout.
I think they're going to go for it, David. I think that's what's going on.
Wow.
And, you know, this may be the right call, David. Just given Country Day's offense and what they're capable of doing, you know, it's so critical to stay on the plus side of this ball game right now. And of course, you do have a touchdown lead right here. But I really think they're going to go for it. I think that's why he took the timeout.
Well, I got to tell you, Saul, you and I have been doing these games for 10 years, but I've been watching football for a long time. And I got to tell you, going for it on 4th and 2, this isn't 4th and inches. This isn't 4th and a yard. This is 4th and a long 2 yards Eagles are electing to go for here.
I think you have to take into context what you've been able to do to them so far tonight, run the football, especially with Hunter Herring run the football. And I think it's so tempting to go for it right here. And I really think if you're Country Day on their sideline, the last thing they want us to do is go for it because I think they don't know that they can stop us.
This is a huge play. I don't know if they're going to try to go with Steady in the saddle here.
He's definitely an option.
An eye backfield beside Herring in the gun. Calls for the ball. They get a block. Herring cuts this one up. He's got the first down and more. He's still on his feet. He's across the 40, across the 50, across the 40, the 35. Horse collar tackle not going to be called. Now it is going to be called. He's going to be dropped out of bounds at about the 25-yard line. Well, you know what? Now I totally agree with going forward on fourth down as the Eagles come up with a huge play.
And I think of course it's the right call now, David, but like we said, they have not been able to stop us running the football, specifically with Hunter Herring running the football. So that's what they wanted us to do is punt that football. They did not want us to go for it because I don't believe they thought they could stop us. I think they're going to get a horse collar personal foul. I think they're going to get a personal foul penalty on us as well after the play.
A gain of 48 yards on the play, enough for a community pharmacy first down. And now we're going to have to wait for the penalty. This may take it inside the Randall's Fine Meat red zone. But
maybe it's not going to be on us.
No indication, but it is a personal foul, horse collar tackle. And there is no other penalty coming, Saul. That's going to be a big one.
The second referee threw it real late, but I guess he was throwing it on the same thing, the horse collar tackle, which there definitely was.
They're going to put this inside the Randall's Fine Meat red zone at the 14-yard line. First down and 10 for the Eagles. Hunter Herring in the shotgun. Two running backs with him in the gun. Turns, hands this one to Fitzhugh. Fitzhugh, patient run, trying to find his way through traffic. And that's a tough run that time as it looks like he got back to the 10. So a gain of 3. Donnie will give him 3, close to 4. But it's going to bring up second down and 7 as they spot this at the 11-yard line. Minute and 33 seconds left to play here in the third quarter. Want to thank the folks at Firm Foundations Counseling for their sponsorship of the third quarter. If you're interested in learning more about EMDR trauma therapy, call Firm Foundations Counseling today, 318-654-7010, or online at myfirmfoundations.com. Saul, when you really don't need an illegal procedure call, we're going to get hit with one, and that's going to be illegal motion against the Eagles. It's going to back them up five and put us behind the chains. And now you're going to be looking at second and call it 12, maybe 13 as a result. Ball now at the Country Day 17-yard line. Minute and 7 seconds left to play in the game. Clock never stopped, even with the penalty. Clock continues to run. Eagles lead 28-21. Herring in the shotgun. Going to send Eckstein in motion. They fake the speed. Now Herring looking for a block. Now he's got one. He's down to the 10, the 5. Touchdown, Ouachita Christian. Number 11, Hunter Herring, is going to take it in. From 17 yards out.
Just a great run by Hunter Herring that time. The Eagles went an unbalanced line to the right side. And last week, whenever they sent Eckstein in motion, most of the time when Herring faked to him, he would go back to the other side of the formation, but this time he carried it to the same side that Eckstein was going in motion to, the side of the unbalanced line, and it looked like Country Day had it played pretty well, but just a tremendous cut by Hunter Herring to get upfield.
Very important extra point. Harrell gets his leg into this one. Looks good from here, and it is, as the Eagles lead is 35-21. Saul able to stay on the plus side of things, and you have to, again, tip your hat to this Country Day team. I don't know if you're feeling the same thing I am, but, boy, two plays into their last possession, Country Day able to put points, a touchdown on the board, and you just have a feeling there's no quit left in these guys, a very well-coached football team with some great athletes.
Yeah, if they're able to come back from this, that would be tremendous, because they're getting physically just beaten up on this football field, and the only way they've been able to really do anything was with the trick play here in the second half, and just a great job by the Eagles so far tonight of just being physical. We talked about at the beginning of the ball game that we needed to be the physical team and wear them down. And you got to remember, they've got a lot of people going both ways as well. And the Eagles have just punished them so far in the second half.
Christopher Holyfield has done a great job of kicking the ball so far tonight, landing most of them inside the 10-yard line. Holyfield tees it up at the 40. Christopher gets his leg into it. It's going to be another high kick. This one's going to be a little shorter, fielded cleanly at about the 15. And the Eagles special teams are going to let one get away. And, boy, I tell you what, number 7 just did the Eagles a tremendous favor, Saul, as he wanted to cut back and get going east and west instead of north and south. I have a feeling if he keeps that thing going, he probably scores on this kickoff return. But instead, he holds up, and it gives the Eagle kickoff coverage a chance, as it's going to be a return of 45 yards. But it's going to be first down and 10 for Metairie Park at the Eagle 40-yard line. Just when you think you got things locked up, and Metairie Park strikes again.
Yeah, I really thought he had a touchdown for sure right there. I mean, he's not as fast as you might think he would be, and you know, it's kind of the difference between these receivers this year and the ones we faced 4 or 5 years ago, is that they could really break passes off for long runs, and I think that's why he cut it back.
Avieta is going to put some air into this one. He's got a receiver wide open down the field, and boy, I tell you what, the Eagles are living right, Saul. As that goes into the hands, you had mentioned the quality receiver that Tyler Williams is, and Williams had one hit him in the hands, and it looked like a sure touchdown for the Cajuns, and instead it's going to be an incomplete pass, and it's going to bring up second down and 10.
Yeah, just as I mentioned, talking about Williams' speed, he runs right past Landon Graves that time, had a sure touchdown, and you're right, he dropped one right in his hands, and everything Abieta throws has been right on the money. And that one was perfect there and should have been called for a touchdown.
Second down and 10 for the Cajuns. Avieta is going to pull it in itself. Now the Eagles are going to lose him again. Now Avieta across the 30, across the 20. He's going to break about 6 tackles and go in for the touchdown. Unbelievable that time. Several Eagles with a chance at him as he just breaks tackles and goes in for the score from 40 yards out. And now, that's going to cut into the Eagle lead.
Yeah, Grant Michaud had a chance at him at the line of scrimmage, and Abieta is just too strong, and he's able to break it free. And I thought Fitchie might have a chance to get him as well in the secondary. And it was a good block by their receiver, and Fitchie just not able to get to him, and he just runs away from him for the touchdown.
After this drive, Saul, I totally understand why you said we needed to go for it on fourth down. As they go through us immediately and put points on the board, a chance to cut the lead here to 7 points. The kick is up, and it's good as Country Day cuts into the Eagle lead 28-35. It's a one-score game, just like that.
Yeah, I mean, we knew it was going to be a score fest, and it certainly slowed down as well after that first quarter went by in about 18 minutes. This game is with a lot of scoring here in the second half, and again, you just got to keep that 14-point cushion, so you got to take this football and bring it down the field and score. You got to think pretty soon Country Day may try an onside kick to try to see if they can change this thing around. And I think Coach Fitzhugh's talking to the referee about the kicker for Country Day. On that one, Eckstein didn't even try to block it. Eckstein just ran across the formation. And the kicker, like I mentioned, after he kicked the football, he tried to scoot forward and kick his leg out to see if he could get it hit again. And actually, he did get it hit, but he had moved about 3 yards past where he had actually kicked the football from, trying to draw that penalty, and the officials didn't throw it. And I think Fitchie's going down there and talking to him and saying, hey, look, you know, what are we supposed to do if he's going to run into us? You know, there's nothing we can do to avoid it.
Be interesting to see how many times this year they've been able to get that call. As Lopez is going to tee this up at the 40-yard line. You do begin to wonder when Lopez has kicked the ball deep. He's sky-kicked it. He's directional kicked it. And now the Eagles are going to anticipate an onside kick, Saul, as they bring everybody up. Everybody, again, within 15 yards of the ball. A couple of rows. And Alvarez is looking at the coaching staff a lot on this kick. Was eyeing the sideline on the far side of the field pretty closely. Now, he is going to take a sidestep, which is what he's done for most of his kicks. Now he approaches the ball, and it's going to be a low line drive kick that's going to travel inside the five. Will Fitzhugh's going to take it at the 7. He's across the 20. Now he's across the 25, across the 30, across the 35, still moving the pile, across the 40 before he's upended. At the Eagle 42-yard line, a great return that time out of the senior running back, senior defensive back, senior everything, Will Fitzhugh. Gain of 36 yards on the return, and that's going to set up the Eagles with the ball first down and 10 with 9 seconds left to play here in the third quarter.
Got a score in the second quarter, David. Catholic High Point Coupee leads Southern Labs 7-0. Another interesting thing to note here is that Dugan went out on the last kickoff with a cramp and still hadn't been able to come back in the ball game. So Dugan's out of the ball game, and they'll move Fitzhugh to tailback.
Herring's going to send a man in motion. It's going to be Eckstein. Fakes it, gives this one to Fitzhugh. Fitzhugh's across the 45. Looks like they'll upend him at about the 48-yard line. A gain of 7 yards on the play. It's going to bring up second down and 3, but we're not going to see that play until the fourth quarter, because this football game is going to come down to the fourth quarter. The Eagles with a 7-point lead over Metairie Park Country Day. Let's go down to the sideline and catch up with Sonny Vadreen with the Marion State Bank sideline report. Coach, you ready for this fourth quarter? Well, looks like Coach actually pretty occupied, so maybe he is ready for the fourth quarter. Coach, are you ready down there?
Yeah, man. It's just going off great right now. We just got to keep doing what we're doing. I do not think that they can stop our running game at all. We just got to keep punching at it, try to run as much of the clock off as we can, and try to come up with a stop on defense. It's the same old story. Defensively, we got to do our job. We're losing a little discipline on defense, on coverage, and we got to do a better job attacking. Same thing we talked about before the game. But right now, it's all in the offense's hands. Just keep doing what we're doing, guys.
All right. Thanks a lot, Coach. Coach Sonny Vadreen right down there with Dylan Dugan. So maybe Coach can get in there and try to loosen him up a little bit. Is he still being stretched out for those cramps? Craig Lowry, one of the
Got another score, David, in the second quarter. Jennings is leading Sterlington 20-7.
Wow. The Bulldogs out in front of the Panthers. Second down and 3 for the Eagles. Hunter Herring in the shotgun, and I backfield beside him. Sends Eckstein in motion, fakes it. Now he's going to keep it himself. Hunter's across the 40, across the 30. You're not going to catch him. 10, 5, touchdown, Ouachita Christian. Herring's going to take it in from 51 yards out.
Boy, just a perfectly blocked play by the Eagle offensive line that time as Hunter Herring fakes the speed sweep of his own sweep and actually keeps the ball himself, and the hole opens wide up, wide open inside, and Hunter Herring used his speed to outrun the Country Day secondary. There was no free safety in the middle of the field, and Herring made him pay for it and goes in for the touchdown.
He's fast. He can run, Saul, as he takes that one in from 51. Again, all important extra points. All of them are. High snap. Harold gets his leg into it. It's up. It's good. Eagle lead set is 14 again. 41 to 28 with 11 minutes and 49 seconds left to play. I said 41. It's 42 as they add the extra point as the Eagles lead.
Man, just a tremendous job by this Eagle offensive line of just imposing their will on Country Day. I mean, every single time the ball is snapped, they're just driving their men down the field. And I can't say enough good things about them. And, of course, Hunter Herring is just become a tremendous weapon running the football. And when you've got three guys like Dugan and Herring and Fitchhugh, I mean, it's tough for anybody to stop that three-headed monster that is those two guys. And, you know, Eagles coming to the ball game tonight averaging over 200 yards rushing with Herring having over 650 yards rushing on the season, averaging 7.3 yards per carry, and Fitchhugh averaging 8.8 yards per carry, and Dugan averaging 9 yards a carry. So those guys have been getting it done all year long, and as you can see, it's tough for anybody to stop them, and Country Day's having a hard time shutting down this running game.
Herring touchdown run brought to you by the folks at Trinity Diamonds Direct. For all your diamond needs, visit Trinity Diamonds on Blanchard Street in West Monroe. Christopher Holyfield tees it up at the 40-yard line. Holyfield with a good run-up. This is a low line drive kick, and it's going to be fielded cleanly in the air by the Cajuns. And the Eagles special teams, Saul, have been tough all season, but that time they're going to give up a lot of yards again as the Cajuns start this drive at their own 35-yard line. A nice return that time by Tyler Williams. Gain of 22 yards on the return.
Yeah, it's got to come up with a stop, David. I feel like this ball game will be over because I don't think Country Day can stop us. So what Country Day is thinking on that sideline is we got to go down and score, and then I guarantee you they're going to kick an onside kick if they were to score it here to try to somehow stop this Eagle offense by just keeping them off the field and getting and stealing the possession.
First down and 10 for the Cajuns. Ibieta looks to throw. He's going to pull it down. Now he's feeling some heat. He's going to just sidestep Eagle defenders. Now he throws it across his body, and that one's incomplete. Fortunate that time for the Eagles, Saul. Ibieta decided to pull it down and throw. It looked like he had an easy first down yardage on the far side of the field. It's going to bring up second down and 10. And again, Saul, two Eagle defenders with an opportunity for a sack, just unable to corral the senior quarterback, Justin Ibieta.
Yeah, he's just a big, strong guy, David. And I have no telling how many people have bounced off him tonight. And he keeps his eyes downfield while he's doing it. It's just like he just flicks people off of him. And that time delivered a strike, just not complete.
Ibieta again to throw, again feels pressure. This time he does decide to pull it down. He's got running room. He's across the 50. Will Fitchhugh is finally going to hem him up, but not after a huge gain on the play. And again, Ibieta, unable to get it done with his arm, gets it done with his legs, a gain of 22 yards on the play. Huge chunk of yardage. First down and 10 now for the Cajuns at the Eagle 42-yard line. Clock running with 11 minutes and 19 seconds left to play in the ball game. Eagles lead 42 to 28. First down and 10, Metairie Park Country Day at the Eagle 42-yard line. Justin Ibieta turns. He looks to throw. Fires this one out in the flat quickly, and it's going to be incomplete. He was looking for number 10, Daniel Cornwell, and that one's going to go in and out of his arms, second down and 10.
Yeah, tried to run a little tunnel screen that time, and he had it again, a perfect throw by him. And, you know, Ibieta just kind of shakes his head, you know, like, what more can I do? Because he's doing everything, David. And that time he put it right on the money, and Cornwell drops it. So a couple of uncharacteristic drops by Country Day here in the second half.
Ibieta brings the Cajuns to the line. Second down and 10. Ibieta looks to throw. He's going to put a lot of air into this one. He's got a receiver down there. It's going to be caught. No, it's going to be dropped. No, it can't be. There's no way. The ball can't. How is that possible? There's no way you could rule that a touchdown. So all the ball came out as soon as he hit the ground.
Well, the official that called the touchdown is walking over. The other two were talking about it. I mean, he comes down on the ground, lands on his back, and the ball pops up in the air, and it looks like they're going to say that he had possession of it before it came out.
That's an unbelievably bad call. That is an unbelievably bad call. But it's going to go the way of the Cajuns, and there's not going to be any discussion. There's not going to be any review in high school football. They're going to give them a touchdown. Ball was just simply incomplete, it looked like, from here. But the Cajuns are going to attempt an extra point attempt. And Lopez is going to handle the kick, and he does. And basically does. So all that time, I saw him twist his hip and take a good yard step hop after the kick. But it's good.
Yeah, so the rule is, David, that the ground can't cause a fumble when you're running the football. But when you're catching the football, you've got to have control of it when you come to the ground. And so he had control of it as he was falling to the ground. But as soon as his back hit the ground,
the ball popped loose.
And so, you know, it would not, you know, definitely if you're talking about college football, pro football, and they saw that on a replay, it would be overturned. But in this case, you know, the official caught it. The other two talked about it and didn't overrule him. And so it becomes a touchdown catch. I've never seen.
I mean, it was clear. I mean, there's no way. I mean, he landed. The ball popped out. It's incomplete. They ruled a touchdown. He stood over it for a second before signaling. But it does. It's going to go down as a touchdown. And like you said, so all what you got to do now is get to work on the ground game. You cannot give these guys the football and an opportunity to tie this football game. They trail by 7 now. How do you know that this isn't going to be the onside kick?
Yeah, you know, I called it last time. I thought that they would do it this time, but it looks like they're not intending on doing it. It looks like they're going to go ahead and try to kick this thing deep.
Well, the Eagles are very aware. So all the hands team guys are all up on the line. They've been waiting on this onside kick for several possessions now. Eckstein stands ready for sure. But they are going to kick it deep, and this one's going to go through the end zone. Alvarez has a lot of things he can do with his leg, and that time he just decides to kick it through the end zone and does.
Yeah, just got to keep answering them, David. This is the same game that we had a few years ago with them, and we were controlling the ball on the ground, and then they ultimately came up with a stop deep in their own territory, and that completely changed the ball game. So the Eagle offense, the best cure to the Country Day offense is just to keep scoring, and then they can't win the ball game, right? Because we've got the advantage right now, having a touchdown lead.
Dugan's still on the sideline. Herring and Fitzhugh in the shotgun. Herring sends Eckstein in motion, fakes it to him. Now he's going to keep it himself. He's across the 25. Now he's across the 30 with running room. Across the 40, stiff arm. Across the 50, the 40, the 30, the 20, the 10, the 5. Touchdown, Wichita Christian. No flags. Touchdown covers 80 yards. Herring with plenty of speed to spare as he outran the defense. And he takes it in for a touchdown.
Well, it was you that said he's fast. Now, I don't know how fast those DBs for Country Day are, but whatever. He outran him and just ran off and left him. As it looked like number two for Country Day, C.D. St. Hilaire, had a chance at him. And he had the angle on Hunter Herring as well. And Herring just ran off and left him that time. So a great job by Hunter Herring rushing the football tonight as he takes that ball the distance for a touchdown.
All important extra point. A good snap. A good hold, and a kick is good as the Eagles increase their lead. 10 minutes and 41 seconds left to play in the ball game. Eagles lead 49 to 35. Now the officials, Saul, I guarantee you they're down there talking about it right now. They're talking about the touchdown pass. And the official is sitting there. Oh, I know he is. He signaled. He's like, I put my hands up. And I mean, you can see him down there talking about it right now. And he's writing it down. That was just an unbelievably bad call. But, you know, it is what it is. And the Eagles do what they need to do, which is shake it off and put more points on the board. As Hunter Herring with an 80-yard touchdown run.
That gives him 251 yards rushing so far in this ball game. David's averaging 19 yards a carry. That's his fourth touchdown rushing tonight. Of course, Will Fitzhugh's got a couple of touchdowns on the ground as well.
Man, you get a 14-point lead, Saul, and you think you might get to take a deep breath in this thing, but you just can't, because this team that we're playing from Metairie Park Country Day is unbelievably talented. They got a quarterback that can throw it on you for a touchdown at any minute, and he can also run it. But we got a quarterback of our own that's doing a little bit of the same. Christopher Holyfield tees it up at the 40-yard line. He's going to try an onside kick. It's going to take an Eagle bounce. The Eagles may come up with it. No indication yet. It looks like Eckstein's got it.
Got it.
It looks like Eckstein's got it.
It is first down Eagles! First down Eagles! You want to turn the tables on an onside kick, the Eagles do it! First down, Ouachita Christian.
And how about that, Dave? We've been talking about, hey, when's Country Day going to kick an onside kick? Where are they going to kick an onside kick? And they certainly weren't expecting us to kick the onside kick, but just a tremendous call by Stephen Fitchie. You know, two of the biggest calls of his career, in my opinion, tonight. The call and the decision to go for it on fourth down in your own territory a few possessions ago, and then that decision right there to call for the onside kick, and a great job by Eli Eckstein to go up and get that ball.
Saw you and I both and saw Metairie Park, he had a hold of it, and Eckstein just simply ripped it away. And the Eagles now with the ball first down and 10 in Metairie Park Country Day territory at the 46-yard line. Herring sends Eckstein in motion, fakes it to him. Now they're going to give this one to Fitchie. Fitchie's going to fall forward for yardage across the 40-yard line. Saw it look like they were going to hem him up for about a 2-yard gain. He's going to turn that into a gain of, well, 7, and it's going to bring up second down and 3. Clock running, 10 minutes. Well, actually, the clock's not running. No idea why the clock would not
Maybe
be running.
A penalty.
Wow. That's two huge holding calls against the Eagles on first down. Both real positive yardage plays, and that's going to back them up.
Of course, you know, David, when you're averaging 19 yards a carry, you know, you don't really feel like the holding penalty can even stop you here, but it certainly puts a damper on what was a great run by Will Fitchie that time. Not really sure who they got from the holding penalty right there. It may have been Miller, who looked like he drove his defender into the sideline, but not sure who they called it on.
Well, we've got a stoppage of play. Not sure, but now the officials are going to signal it ready for play. They wind the clock. 10 minutes and 22 seconds left to play here in the ball game. Eagles lead 49-35, and it looks like they're going to let as much of this play clock run down as they can. Herring is going to let the clock run. Now inside of 10, 9, before they snap this football. Herring calls for the ball. He's going to keep it himself. Tough running inside. He's across the 50. Now he's across the 45, the 40. Stays in bounds. Goes down in bounds. Going to have more than enough for another Community Pharmacy first down. A gain of 27 yards on the play. And it looked to me like, Saul, he got down. And it would be interesting to see if they wind this clock when they signal it ready for play, or if he was signaled out of bounds.
Yeah, great job of running again by Hunter Herring, and a great job by the offensive line. It's been really both sides of the offensive line that have been that's been controlling the line of scrimmage, and again an excellent run by Hunter Herring. Like I said, when you're averaging 19 yards a carry, first and 20 is no problem.
9 minutes and 53 seconds left to play in the game. They keep it on the ground with Fitchie. He's going to cut this one back. Got to the line of scrimmage and picked up a little bit more. Gain of 3 yards. Oh, my goodness. This is, Saul, I'm telling you, that is one of the most unbelievable calls I've ever seen. I mean, he throws a flag at least. I mean, it happened in front of two referees, and a guy over here near us throws a flag.
Yeah, they're going to get Eli Eckstein as he was, you know, sort of hand fighting after play, and then he actually took his man and threw him down. And it was an easy call for the official since it happened so far, so long after play. But it looks
no
like he's going to wave it off.
Exactly. So now the Eagles are going to pick up 4 yards on the play. Actually, well, gain of 3, long 3, short 4. Second down and 6 or 7. They spot this football at the Country Day 27-yard line. Cooler heads have got to prevail this time of the game. 9 minutes and 30 seconds. Clock continues to run. The Eagles saw with 30 seconds on the play clock. They could run this thing down inside 9 minutes just by standing at the ball.
I think you'll see Hunter Herring carry this football again, David, as they just had him. It's interesting how they've done a pretty good job on the running backs tackling, but anytime Herring carries the football, they just have no answer for it.
They're going to let this clock run, and I don't blame them. Great job of managing time here. Inside of 10 seconds on the play clock, Herring sends Eckstein in motion. Going to fake it to him to give this one to Fitchie. Fitchie's got some running room. 25, 20, 15, 10, 5! Before he's upended at the goal line.
And Fitchie with a great job of staying in bounds that time, David, as well. It looked like they were going to drive him out of bounds, and Fitchie was able to kind of cut the ball up the field and keep the ball in bounds, and going to run a lot of time again off this clock, and the Eagles with a chance to go up by 21 here, David, and just take complete control of this ball game.
Gain of 22 yards on the play, enough for a Community Pharmacy first down. Eagles with the ball, first and goal at the 5-yard line, actually 4-yard line inside the Randall's Fine Meat red zone. 8 minutes and 39 seconds left to play in the game. Eagles lead 49-35. Hunter Herring's gonna let this play clock get down inside of 10. Takes the ball, gonna keep it himself, sets up, goes inside, goes in untouched. Don't know how much motivation there really was that time by Metairie Park at all, so it didn't really look like anybody tried to tackle him.
Well, they've been getting ripped so bad, David, up front. I mean, they're just getting driven back on their back every play. And that time you saw it, I mean, you and I could have scored on that ball, on that play that time, as Hunter Herring had nobody near him, and he just kind of walks into the end zone untouched. And again, just got to give a tremendous amount of credit to this Eagle offensive line tonight as they have just imposed their will on Country Day.
Harrell on to attempt the extra point for the Eagles. A good snap this time. Harrell gets his leg into it. It looks good from here, and it is. Sam Harrell saw doing a great job. Missed one early, but he's been perfect since as the Eagles increase their lead over Metairie Park Country Day, 56-35. Let's go down to the sideline and catch up with Coach Sonny Vedrine. Coach, if you were listening, Saul said he thought he or I could have walked that one in with the hole there.
Yeah, I tell you what, they just kind of give up the ghost on that last play right there, and they're tired. This offensive line has absolutely just beat them down tonight, and I tell you what, I don't know how many yards rush we got, 400, 500, but I mean, they're not even hardly putting a hand on Hunter Herring at all. It's pretty good job. We just got to come up with a good play on defense right now and let this thing get crazy on us and come down a last minute or two. I just don't want to see that happen. But just play a good, solid defense right here, make a play, and get another score.
I hear you. Thanks a lot, Coach. Coach Sonny Vedrine with the Marion State Bank sideline report.
Got another couple of scores, David, to pass along. At halftime, Destrehan's leading West Monroe 17-6. Oak Grove leads Homer 28-12. And that's all I got right now.
All right. Thanks a lot, Saul, with a couple of Magic Grill in-game scoreboard updates brought to you by the folks at Magic Grill. Here at our game, it's 56-35. Christopher Holyfield gets his leg into this one. This one's going to travel in a different spot, fielded cleanly at about the 20-yard line. Good job this time by the Eagle coverage as they get down. So good job of coverage, just a real short kick that time as Holyfield's kick is going to be returned. A gain of, 16 yards on the return. It's going to be first down and 10 from Metairie Park at their own 36-yard line.
Yeah, never is it more important than right now to not give up a big play, David. Make them use some time driving this ball down the field. Let them complete it in front of you, and then just make the tackle. Keep Abietta in front of you. You don't mind him running the football now. Just don't let him get any big gains. Just let him run the ball if he wants to. Just make sure you keep him in front of you and tackle him.
We need a spy. Abietta looks to throw, pulls us down quick, and he does. He gets this one out in the flat, completes number one, Tyler Williams. Williams is going to pick up a first down, but more importantly, he's going to stay in – well, I say more importantly, he is going to stay in bounds. Gain of 12 yards. Clock will stop as they move the chains. 8 minutes and 12 seconds left to play in the football game. Eagles lead 56-35. Clock starts, 8 minutes left to play in the game. Abietta with one running back with him in the backfield. Two receivers left, two to his right. Fakes, looks to throw. It's a pump fake. Now he's going to step into one. He's got a receiver wide open downfield, and it's going to be incomplete. And Saul, that time again, Tyler Williams was running away from his defender. A well-thrown football would have been another touchdown, but the Eagles fortunate that Abietta unable to find the range on that one.
Yeah, I'm not sure that was Tyler Williams, David. It looked like that was number seven, Dylan Simmons, that time, I believe. But a good football throw gave him a chance to make a play, but actually that was I think that was Aiden Hamm that was on the coverage. It wasn't bad coverage. Aiden Hamm made it tough on him, but you can't let him get behind you like that would happen right there.
Second down and 10, Abietta throws this one, and this one for sure is Williams, and Williams is going to be upended. Going to bring up third down and short. Obvious four-down territory, gain of 7 yards. It's going to be third and 3.
He had a really good tackle by Fitchie that time. He keeps him short of the line of the game. More importantly, keeps that clock rolling as well.
7 minutes and 33 seconds left to play in the football game. Third down and 4. Big play here, but obvious four-down territory. Third down and three, ball at the Eagle 45. Abieta in the shotgun, four receivers. Abieta pulls this one down. Again, a cushion over there on the far side of the field. So it almost looks like they're willing to kind of give Williams that 1 yard or that 3 to 4 yard gain as he picks up six on the play, and that's going to be enough for a first down for Metairie Park.
Yeah, like I said, that's okay, David. Just let them catch the football in front of you. Make them take a lot of time off the clock trying to score here. I mean, you got a 3-touchdown lead with now it's going to be under 7 minutes before they get this ball off.
Abieta in the shotgun. Ball at the Eagle, 38. Abieta with some pressure, and the Eagles are going to drop him. Big play that time for Ouachita Christian, a loss of 2 yards on the play.
And Ethan Hogan with a great job that time, as instead of trying to tackle him up high, Ethan Hogan just put his hands around his ankles, and then Jacob Ogden finished him off that time for the loss.
Second down and 12 for the Cajuns. Clock continuing to run. 6 minutes, 15 seconds left to play in the ball game. Abieta gets a good snap. He finds some time, sets up a middle screen. Had one man there to make the play, and the Eagles finish him off. Great job that time in the secondary, Saul. As you could see the middle screen set up, a gain of 11 yards on the play, but they needed 12 for a first down, so it's going to bring up third down and short, maybe third and about half a yard.
Yeah, good job by Mashaw that time to keep him short of the line of gain, and now they're going to go in their power formation here. David, see if they can pick up the first down and keep this drive going.
Clock continues to run. 5 minutes and 45 seconds left to play in the ball game. Abieta turns. No, now he's gonna bring that. They almost had a sack, and now the Eagles are going to lose contain on Abieta. They had him dead to rights, and he escapes, and he's going to have a first down and some change. Boy, I tell you what, Saul, he is an impressive quarterback. No wonder he's committed to Tulane.
Yeah, I'm wondering maybe if he could go somewhere even better than Tulane after watching tonight, David. He's got everything you'd want in a quarterback, and he just tremendous. And that time he breaks a what should have been a sure sack from the backside. He's able to just brush him off and get up the field and break another tackle for the first down.
5 minutes, 20 seconds left to play in the football game. Eagles lead 56-35. Abieta sends a man in motion, pulls this one down, looks to throw. It's going to be complete out in the flat. And that's going to be number 7, Dylan Simmons. Simmons is going to try to get upfield, but a great job in the defensive secondary as the Eagles hold him to a minimal gain, a gain of 4. It's going to bring up 2nd down and 6 as they spot this football at the Eagle 14-yard line.
Really
5 minutes left to play in the football game, Saul.
Be less than 5 minutes when they snap this ball again, David. And a great open field tackle by Will Fitchie that time as the Eagles doing exactly what they need to do on this drive. Other than holding them and getting the ball back, they're at least making them work hard for this touchdown and taking off a tremendous amount of time.
2nd down and 6. Abieta with time puts some air into this one. He's got a receiver in the back corner of the end zone, and it's going to be incomplete. Nice job of coverage that time in the back of the end zone. Looked like Graves was back there, sawing, and it's going to be incomplete as he was looking for Williams.
Yeah, probably the first real mistake of the ball game by Abieta that time, as he was late on that throw. Is Williams with a great move to shake Graves in the end zone, and was wide open.
Looks like Graves is shaking up back there too, Saul. He's hunched over, maybe needing some help here.
Well, Abieta was just late throwing the football, allowed Graves a chance to come up there and knock that ball loose.
Abieta looks to throw. Now he's going to pull it down. He is feeling some heat. He's going to be held up at the line of scrimmage. The Eagles are going to be there. It's going to be 4th down. He gains 2 yards. Needed 6. It's going to be 4th and 3.
Yeah, great job.
4th and 4.
Great job by Casey Cobb that time as he had a hold of him. And Abieta still able to fight forward for a couple of extra yards, but Casey Cobb never let go of him and able to bring him down short of the fourth.
So could you say this is the ball game here? I mean, obviously with 4 minutes left to play, 4th down and 4, ball at the Eagle 12-yard line. Abieta in the shotgun, takes a snap, pump fake, looks to throw quick. No indication if it was caught. They're going to say he caught the football. Boy, it was tough to see from our vantage point, but that's going to be complete, and it's going to bring up 1st down and goal.
Boy, Graves just was almost there to make the plays. Abieta kind of pump fake and had a chance for on a little hitch route like that. If you pump fake, it gives the defensive back a chance to get there. And Graves looked like I thought he was going to be able to knock it down, but somehow Abieta able to squeeze that ball in there to Williams for the first down. Big play by Country Day.
Clock continues to run inside 3.5 minutes. Abieta looks to throw. He does. That was complete to Williams. And Williams, it looks like he's going to be short, and he is. And more time, Saul. Not only he's real close for the to the touchdown, but 3 minutes and 30 seconds left to play in the ball game.
Of course, Eagles leading 56-35. David, a 21-point lead now with under 4 minutes, under 3.5 minutes now. So they've done what they need to do and make Country Day take a lot of time off this clock, even
if they score
here.
I'm looking for the sneak here, but Abieta has different plans as they go right up the middle. Looks like the Eagles are going to hold them. More time coming off the clock. Is that time they go with Isaacs that time, Saul, and he's going to come up short. It's going to bring up third down and goal at the 2-yard line.
Now it's going to get under 3 minutes before this next next snap. And I'm with you. I can't believe they didn't have Abieta just carried it himself.
Now they do, and it looks like he'll fall in for the score. Just simple fall forward, and that touchdown's going to go. So 2 minutes and 53 seconds left to play here in the football game. Metairie Park's going to score. Abieta takes it in from the goal line, essentially about a 6-yard carry. I mean, about a 6-inch carry. It looks like Metairie Park's going to decide to go for two. As Abieta lines up in the shotgun, three receivers, and he's going to look to throw quickly. Has to pull it down. Now it's going to be incomplete.
I don't understand that call at all.
I have no idea either, Saul.
But there you go. I mean, that's as important as anything. And now Metairie Park definitely has to go for two the next time if they get the ball back and they're able to score.
How are you feeling about that onside?
I guarantee they'll try it this time, David. Great job by the Eagles on that drive. Even though Metairie Park comes down and scores the football, the Eagles make them take a tremendous amount of time off this clock. And still, Eagles with the lead by 15 points, 56-41, with 2 minutes 53 seconds left to go in this ball game. And I think this crowd can kind of feel the victory here, David.
Want to thank tonight's fourth quarter sponsor, Ouachita Christian Football, Eagle Point Boat and RV Storage. Eagle Point Boat and RV Storage, located on beautiful Lake Darbonne in Farmerville. Proud supporter, Ouachita Christian Eagle Football. Again, we'd like to thank the folks up at Eagle Point Boat and RV Storage for their continued support of Ouachita Christian Athletics.
Got another halftime score, David. Neville leads Westgate 19-14 at halftime.
Neville on top of Westgate again. Another Magic Grill in-game scoreboard update with the folks at Magic Grill. Saul, you've been calling for the onside. I've never seen somebody kick one onside from 10 yards away from the ball, but it's possible. He's going to approach this one. Does go with the onside. And Eagles got it! The Eagles got it, Eckstein! Eckstein has been a demon on special teams tonight for the Eagles as he comes up with another one.
And the good thing what he did, David, he didn't wait for it to go 10 yards. He came up and got that ball out of the air, and that's what you have to do. If you wait on it, they're coming to block you. And Eckstein just with perfect execution on that one. And, of course, he able to recover the onside kick for the Eagles when they had an onside kick of their own to really change this ball game. And now the Eagles can just run this clock down and get out of here with a win, David.
2 minutes and 20 seconds. Clock continues to run. 17 seconds. The Eagles have just got to run a few plays. And now the officials are going to call timeout. So I think what they're disputing is the fact that When Eckstein recovered that ball, the clock continued to run. So they're going to probably put a few more seconds on the clock. And Eli Eckstein's contributions tonight, saw on special teams, you know, we had that squib kick or sky kick, looked like it was going to land right in the middle. Eckstein scoops it up, takes it 47 yards to set up a score. And then, you know, the onside kick recovery, and then now the I saw some New Orleans Saints last night that could have studied from Eli's playbook as he runs to meet the ball rather than wait for it to hit him.
And really, you could argue the play of the ball game that totally changed this game was his touchdown catch right before half with no time left on the clock to change this ball game as well, as the Eagles looked like they were kind of behind the scoreboard.
Because we were.
And I guess I should, we talked about earning the ball game. This is going to be a back and forth game. At that time, the Eagles had not been able to capitalize. And as a result, Metairie Park up by 7, and the Eagles are able to score right before half and then take the ball back on the second half, kickoff and go down and score, and really just change this ball game.
2 minutes and 34 seconds left to play in the ball game. Herring's going to turn. He hands this one to Fitzhugh. Fitzhugh with a nice, tough run. picks up what he can, a gain of 2 yards, both hands on the football. Clock's going to run inside of 2 minutes and 20 seconds.
Battery Park has all three of their timeouts. I'm not really sure why they're not using a timeout right here.
Second down and 8 for the Eagles. They're going to let as much of this play clock wind down as they can. Saw a little guilty last week against Calvary of running some plays, I thought, a little early. Could have let some more time run off. 18 seconds on the play clock. Clock goes under 2 minutes. A minute and 57 seconds. Now we're at 10. Herring in the shotgun. Going to send Eckstein in motion. Calls for the ball. Fakes it. Now he's going to keep it himself. Herring with a nice, tough run. Battling his way across the 40-yard line. Going to be real close to a Community Pharmacy first down. A gain of 7. They needed 8. He's going to be just a little shy as Metairie Park is going to call one of those timeouts here, Saul.
Yeah, and of course, the Eagles in a great position right now as they make Metairie Park use one of their timeouts, and now they're in short yardage situations. You got 2 down. Now, they're not going to punt right here, so you got to go 1 yard and 2 downs, and I like our chances. And then I don't think Metairie Park can do anything about it. As the Eagles up 15 points here with 1 minute 41 seconds left to go in this ballgame. It's still a little confused as to why Metairie Park
went for the 2-point, yeah.
Their kicker is excellent, and the 2-point doesn't really give you much unless you're just thinking, hey, we come down and win this ball game at the end. But if that's the case, wait till the very last score to go for 2.
Well, it is going to bring up 3rd down and 1 yard for the Eagles. A minute 41 seconds left to play in the ball game. Eagles lead 56-41. This has been a whale of a football game. 3rd down and less than 1 yard. Hunter Herring in the shotgun. Will Fitzhugh beside him in the gun. A good snap from center. Hunter's going to keep it himself. He's got the 1st down, and he's going to immediately go down too, Saul. Takes a knee, gains 3 yards, and that's going to be enough for a Community Pharmacy 1st down. Clock is going to continue to run. Now we're at a minute. Well, actually, the clock starts now as they've set the chains.
And I'm not so sure you can't just go in victory formation right now. They do have 2 timeouts left. I think they're going to do that. They're just going to go into victory formation, David. It looks like we're going to run this ball game out, and we're going to be playing for the state championship.
It's going to be 1st down and 10. Ball at the Metairie Park Country Day 35-yard line. The Eagles are going to line up in a victory formation. So many things great happened tonight. I never saw the onside kick coming. Herring's going to snap the ball with 2 seconds on the play clock. And now, Saul, it's going to be ball game. I mean, there's virtually nothing that can be done. I mean, the play clock's at 33 seconds. There's 50 left on the clock. I mean, Metairie Park could call a timeout. Obviously, I think they have at least 1 left. But I don't think the Cajuns are going to – I think the Cajuns are hugging each other, congratulating each other on a good season. And I'll tell you what, too, Saul, if this is the last play of the game, these kids from Metairie Park came up here to play tonight. This has been a dogfight for 4 quarters. A dogfight for 4 quarters. And the Ouachita Christian Eagles are going to the state championship. They're going to win this game tonight over Metairie Park Country Day 56-41. Big win tonight for the Eagles.
And I tell you, just an unbelievable. They did it the old-fashioned way, David, running the football. And that's proved to be their M.O. We talked about it earlier in the year that this is a team that could run the football effectively. And we saw it tonight as they just imposed their will on Country Day, and they had no answer for them defensively. And, man, I tell you what, they faced a heck of a quarterback, as good a quarterback as I've seen in high school football in a long time. And he just didn't have enough weapons to help him out on defense. He couldn't play defense, too. I mean, I guess he could play defense, but he only played it on 1 play tonight. And just a tremendous job by the Eagle, this Eagle team. And man, I got to tip my hat to those guys that don't get a lot of credit. That's the offensive line because they made it happen tonight.
Yeah, Tim Mosier, too. I want to tip my hat to Coach Mo. He does such a great job with that offensive line, Saul, every season. We're going to go down and see if we can catch up with Ouachita Christian former defensive coordinator, Coach Sonny Vadreen, with the Marion State Bank sideline report. Coach, what's going on down there?
Man, they just shaking hands, and we're just glad this thing is over with, guys.
Well,
and,
Coach,
we're going on the state championship. That's all I can tell you.
Well, Coach, what do you think? You think we're going to play this thing in a couple of weeks in New Orleans, or are we going to host here at the school?
At this point, I don't think anybody cares. We're just in a state championship. If we get to Superdome, it'd be wonderful. If not, we'll play it right here.
I agree, Coach.
I mean, and I don't know that really matters one way or the other. It would be nice to go to the Superdome for the kids because they've earned it for a long time. But if you're not, you get to play here in front of your home crowd, play a state championship game. You know what? I can't think that's been done, you know, never. This would be the first state championship game ever at OCS. And that'd be an awesome thing to have.
I'll tell you what, Coach, I'm going to just tell you right now, if we had weather like we had tonight, I'd rather play here anyway.
Well, you know, I'm not against it. I just want to play in state championship. That was a great game tonight. Guys really played well. Offensive line, you can't say enough things about them. And of course, Country Day came up and played a hard game. They came up to win tonight, and they did all they could do. And we just had too much for them. And Hunter Herring played a great game. So did Will Fitchhugh. And Dugan did. Everybody did, guys. We just did a great job. The offensive line, you can't give them enough credit for what the offensive line has done. And the defense played well enough to do all they needed to do. So that onside kick was a great call right there when we got that done. That was amazing. And then X9 getting an onside kick from them, that was a great thing because that could have changed the game if they had got that onside kick. You know, things could have happened differently. But as it is, we won the game, and we're going to the state championship.
Absolutely. Thanks a lot, Coach. Coach Sonny Vedrine with the Marion State Bank sideline report. The Ouachita Christian Eagles are going to defeat Metairie Park Country Day 56-41. And thanks a lot, Coach. Saul, I'll tell you what, this was as advertised. I did not think we were going to have, honestly, as big a struggle as we did with Metairie Park Country Day. I thought that the Eagles were going to do a good job tonight, and they did. But, man, I tell you what, Metairie Park brought a team up here, and this thing was tight for four quarters tonight.
Yeah, I mean, I knew that they were going to be able to move the football, David, and the quarterback was too good. Their receivers were good. I mean, you put a lot of pressure on a high school football team when you can do the things that football team could do. But, again, we made some key stops when we needed to, and the offense was just lights out. The special teams was great, and it was just an all-around team effort. And I will disagree with Coach Regina a little bit. I'd like to know when we're going to play just to find out, you know, when that game's going to be. Is it going to be next week? Is it going to be 2 weeks? And hopefully we can find that out pretty soon. And Coach Fitchhugh, I know his desire, I believe, is to try to play this thing in 2 weeks in New Orleans, but it's just going to be whether or not he can get the right answer he wants from the LHSAA.
Well, I think all of that will work itself out next week as this football team is going to play for a state championship, which is, you know, the ultimate goal, Saul, is to win a state championship, but you can't win one unless you're dancing. And the Eagles are going to have a chance to win a state championship, another state championship, and hang another one of these banners up at Fitzhugh Field at Eagle Stadium. The Ouachita Christian Eagles win this one tonight, 56-41. We're going to take a quick break. We'll come back here. Saul will give us the final tally of the stats tonight, and we're going to call this one a night. You're listening to Ouachita Christian Eagle football on 92.3 The Wolf.